Big old problem. Let's listen in on the rest of our national anthem here in Cincinnati.
I hope our voiceover guy's okay. I'm very excited to see what letter C we have tonight in Cincinnati as Chicago takes on Cincinnati, and today's climate is splendid with a letter S. It's our Four Seasons weather, 66 degrees, 36% humidity. That's gonna take me like two innings to get over that. That
I
is
thought it was beautiful. Perfect.
DJ, you come over here for one game and everything breaks loose. That's crazy town. Let's take a look at our Insure on the Spot starting lineup. Get your free auto insurance quote. I love it. In just 2 minutes at insureonthespot.com. Hard hit baseballs is what you see in the right column. Abreu leading the team with 82. Eloy with 81 of them. Nick Madrigal in the top spot today. Yomer giving Tim just a regularly scheduled day off. He didn't get many.
No, he doesn't get many. I know this. He's going to have to get it done tonight. As you look at, he's going to take that time off, and Tyler Malley is going to be happy about it. You see his overall numbers, 8 games, 7 starts, 1-2, a 4.31 ERA, and Malley likes to feature a four-seam fastball, slider, a splitter, which we've been seeing more of those of late, and a curveball. And you just heard, we're talking about his pitching arsenal. This is brought to you by Roman, and it's presented by Roman all night long. And he's going to continue, as you see the percentages. 2019, though, look at the difference. You'll see right there, he did not throw a slider in 2019, and how few curveballs he's using this season. Splitter about the same, and guess what? This season, the cutter, he's taken that off the table. And taking a look at the UI Health defense, and it is presented by UI. It is Akiyama on left, Goodwin plays center, Castellanos is the right fielder. From third to first, you get Suarez, Garcia, Moustakas, and Votto. You get the battery of Malley and Tucker Barnhart. Taking a look at our umpires tonight. At home plate, it's Mark Carlson. James Hoy is the first base umpire. Go around over to Mike Esterbrook at second, and Chad Whitson will be at third base.
DJ, it is great to have you here. So glad to be alongside of you one more time.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to you messing with me all night long.
Well, come on now.
Yeah, I'm just going back to what happened last time, Jason.
Yeah, what happened last time is that the Sox were in Washington and played two highly entertaining ball games that we enjoyed together.
Yes.
And so Great American Ballpark, the site. Tyler Malley, first pitch to Nick Madrigal. We are underway at strike one. From the ballpark home of the Cincinnati Reds since 2003, Great American Ballpark. And Nick Madrigal, so far this year, we've seen him and his ability to handle the bat, especially with two strikes. What do you like most about Nick Madrigal?
You know what? I am blown away how composed he has been, settling in so quickly here at the big league level. I didn't expect this. I really didn't, because the scouting report coming in to me was he wasn't quite ready with the bat yet. I've seen the complete opposite of that. Tells you this is a guy that, as they like to say, is a dirt bag, just a true baseball player. Get down and get dirty and show you he can get it done.
Goes upstairs on a high fastball to foul it away. Two strikes on Madrigal. Look, more than half of his hits in his Major League Baseball career, you talk about a hit tool. More than half of his hits have come with two strikes.
Well, right, and he's done a lot of damage using those two strike hits to drive in several runs this year, 8 already.
Another foul ball. He is very difficult to strike out. Nick Madrigal, you mentioned he is a dirtbag, but he didn't go to Long Beach State. Those no, guys that go to Long Beach State, they're called dirtbags.
Yes.
He's from the very proud program up in Corvallis at Oregon State, where they've churned out a lot of big-time players.
Well, you know, all up and down the West Coast, there's going to be a lot of great baseball programs.
You being from Culver City, you know that very closely.
Yeah, well, you know, my program was a little smaller, you know. CCHS, yes, baby. Go got Centaurs.
Got it in before out number two, which I think is a brand new record. You were the Centaurs?
That's
right. You were a half man, half horse?
Well, not me particular, but yes, our mascot.
Two strikes on Madrigal. And Nick over second. Nicky, two strikes, strikes again.
Well, see, keep talking about it, and he'll do it for you. you know, one of the things about this White Sox lineup, and now you get to see it at the top of the lineup, that Nick Madrigal can't handle this pressure of leading things off and getting on for him. He's also the kind of guy, as you well know, Jace, that can, if you need, he can steal a base, even though we're not a big stolen base team. It's nice to know that you have that presence there, and it distracts our pitcher from getting the job done. If you get out there tonight, Mally might be that guy that's too concerned with that speed over there, and it could help this batter that's standing in now, Yasmani Grandal,
who is the most patient White Sox hitter. And there is that throw to first base. We've seen it happen over and over again. You made it happen with pitchers in your career.
Yeah, that was in the minor leagues, though.
You stole a base or two.
Yeah, there you go. You just called my numbers out, a base or two. That was wrong.
But you just said that you didn't do it in the majors. You corrected me to the minors and then slingshotted me back after that. So thank you very much.
You know, I'm not ready for this kind of quickness coming back at me. I work with different guys. You're too quick. All right. I see where we're going tonight. He's going to be really on top of it.
We'll race after to make you feel better about yourself. 0-1 to Grandal, and a snap throw coming to first. They are very preoccupied with Nick Madrigal.
You know, if you're going to be concerned, that's the point. If you're going to worry about Nick Madrigal, who's standing at first base with a total of one stolen base, that is perfect. That's just what you need for your number two, three, and four hitters coming up. If he's going to stay over there at first base, they might get that pitch to drive.
Mally on 0-2. It's a high fastball, one ball and two strikes from Tyler Mally, and you were talking about it. He has refound the slider, really. Went curveball last year, had that cutter before as well, but that slider has turned into a very good pitch for him.
Well, mostly you're going to see the fastball 54% of the time, and then that slider is going to be mixed in right behind it.
Right hand side diving play by Votto, and Joey Votto takes the out over at first base. StatCast powered by Google Cloud. We're talking about wheels, and Jose Abreu to first base in one of the biggest plays of the clincher for the Sox yesterday. His sprint to first was faster than average and his second best run to first all year long.
You know, one of the things about that for me, Jason, is he knew the importance of really getting down that line. And Jose kind of saves it. He keeps it in the tank. He doesn't always run as hard as he can to first base. And I really believe yesterday in that situation, he caught Polanco sleeping. Mm-hmm. He sat back just a little bit like the normal Jose Abreu's running. He got around it, came up and through, and it was too late.
I don't know about you over there doing radio yesterday, but when I turned my attention back to first base, I couldn't believe how far Jose was down the line.
I could believe it.
First pitch is off the plate, ball one. The other part of that is, and we talked about it a little bit, Josh Donaldson, if he's still in that game at third base, he may cut that ball off.
Well, you're right. And you know what? I sent him some candy after the game, thanking him for that great explosion at home plate. I'm like, Josh, you're the best. Here's a little something to remember us by.
Yeah, all the folks doing evening sportscasts as well were very happy about it. Gave them a lot of opportunity for entertainment.
Yeah, if you guys didn't see it or haven't heard yesterday, Josh Donaldson getting a little angry with the strike zone. And after hitting a home run, after the umpire woke him up, he decided to dirty the plate a little bit. And next thing you know, he got tossed from the game. And the replacement player for him didn't do anything to really help them beat the White Sox. So thank you very much.
Yeah, Sox will appreciate that for days and weeks to come.
Yeah, that was something special yesterday, Jason, because think about how long it's been and how hard these guys have worked. And for these younger guys in particular, the Eloy Jimenez who broke onto the scene last year, the Moncada who really had a strong season last year, these guys get to experience something they've never experienced. Now, I look at Tim Anderson and I look at Abreu. These guys have been around here a little longer now.
Yep.
And it's nice that these guys get to see the rewards, I think, a little quicker than anybody could have anticipated. But I know in the locker room, those guys have felt this way, that they can get to the postseason this year.
Yeah, Jose especially, you've got to be happy for Jose Abreu, because he said he wanted to be here. He's been the team leader for a long while now, especially offensively. And he has put together his best season in his major league career.
Yeah, this is really, it seems like he's rejuvenated. Whatever reason has got him where he is, he has really enjoyed this season.
Check swing, foul, first base side. Here is where Jose Abreu ranks in the American League, and he's right to smile and look at that baseball bat like that. He's number one in RBIs, second in home run. And look at the late game stuff that he does for this team.
Yeah, I'm looking at just overall what he does. And we see it every day. You know, we know his value and what he does and how clutch he is. It doesn't surprise us.
1-2, another accidental foul ball. And you know, the count remains.
Something about how when Jose was on that 22 game hitting streak, and you know he was hanging on to that hitting streak, Jason, just getting a little infield hit there, yeah. A little swinging bunt, and it almost looked like he was exhausted trying to keep that hitting streak going. He lost the hitting streak, and I said, now he can get going again, and he did. He just caught fire, started swinging with more authority and driving the baseball again, and he's continued to do so since he lost the hitting streak.
In the air, right field side and toward the corner, and that is a foul ball. That's almost like County Stadium over there, the way it rounds off in the right field corner.
Yes, absolutely. A little bit like that. Absolutely.
I know you chased a baseball or two around that corner in County Stadium.
Yeah, I'm surprised you remember it so well. It's been gone for quite some time now. But
you don't miss it dearly?
No. You know, I played there in Milwaukee, and that was not one of my favorite places stadium wise to play.
Get a little chilly out there as Jose continues to foul baseballs off. We showed this during the Minnesota series. The Sox are top three in baseball in pitches seen in the first and second innings this year.
Well, you know, when you put somebody like Yasmani Grandal at the top of your order, or if you replace him with Yoan Moncada, both of those guys basically average close to five pitches seen per at bat. And plus, they also score a lot of runs and they bat around quite a bit. So it's very nice.
Down and out, two balls, two strikes on Jose Abreu.
Right now, you can definitely see that Mally is trying to work the slider away, and the fastball running in is, you know, Abreu's reputation is one where he will expand the strike zone if you can get him thinking about fastballs.
Yep, down and out, strike three, you called it, two gone.
Now you get him thinking about the fastball in his hands enough, and that's exactly what's going to happen.
So our Geico Make It Easy profile. Hi, Mom. Eloy Jimenez since September began, and don't wake him up when September ends because he will be very alert already. A couple of home runs. He's driven in 12, and that level of emotion that we saw at second base in the game winner yesterday, the eventual game winner. Everybody knows him as this happy-go-lucky guy. He wants to be the best in baseball now.
Oh, I've always looked at Eloy, Jason, and thought that this guy's going to prove a whole bunch of people that he is the best all-around hitter in baseball because he likes to drive the ball the other way. He wants to hit for a high average, and obviously he's got power all directions.
Outside ball one. Mally, by the way, is tennis-like grunting already in the game. He will throw it and tell you he's throwing it.
You know, I've always looked at it as a former player that they're just setting up the slow stuff with a grunt.
Is that right?
Yeah, you know, he's grunting like he's throwing it 100, and then you really know here comes the slow stuff.
That sounds like you got burned by that at some point. Who did that to you?
No, fool me once kind of thing. You know, I was batting down in the lineup, so I got to hear him doing that to other guys. I go, I don't think so. He'll not get me.
The glory of hitting seven, right? You get to see all the tricks first time through.
Absolutely.
1-1 from Mally to Eloy Jimenez. And he swings through a fastball. Mally has a fastball that moves quite a bit and moves late. It has some arm side run, as they say, into right-handers and also a little downward movement as well.
Well, what we're seeing right now is it's definitely got that late life, absolutely, but it's also 95 miles an hour. You put a couple extra miles an hour on it with that kind of life to the batter. And I guarantee right now, with the way he's popped that fastball, even though Eloy seems to be seeing the ball well, he will chase.
Down and out, two balls, two strikes. Madrigal at second after a leadoff single. Nick in the leadoff spot tonight with Tim Anderson getting a much-deserved day off. Two and two. Down and out, three balls, two strikes from Mally.
little bit of a tell right there from Eloy. He's thinking fastball still, but able to lay off that slider away. His left side gave just enough. And, you know, you can always tell what a hitter's thinking by how he takes pitches.
So where do you go here?
I'm waiting to see. Wait a second.
There it was. You knew it was coming. Strike three, went slider. And the inning is over. Reds will bat for the first time against Stever next. And Jesse Winker, the Suarez, one of their big home run hitters.
Well, tonight I know this much. They're going to try and square up, as we used to say, instead of barrel up. Jonathan Stever, you see what he did in his only start. He's got the 2.45 ERA, 3 2/3 innings. We've already set the tone that got off to a bit of a slow start, and just like that, he pulled it back together and retired the last 9 batters he faced. As you see, our Roman arsenal of pitches. Jonathan Stever is going to use the fastball, slider, change, and the curveball.
23 years old, Jonathan Stever from the great state of Wisconsin by way of Indiana, where he did his schooling. As Akiyama takes a ball low, Akiyama spent 9 years with the Cebu Lions out in Japan, a very proud franchise, as you know.
You do know I know. I played there myself. Akiyama fouls this one off to the left, which gives us a little bit of time to set the defense and the UI Health defense. From left to right in the outfield, Jimenez, Robert, Mazzara, around the horn, Moncada, Sanchez, Madrigal, and Abreu. And as you see already, it's Stever and Grandal as the battery.
1-2 from Stever. And he comes inside on Akiyama. You know that swing very well. I mean, I've been doing Korean baseball games. Akiyama played in Japan for a long time. Contact is at the top of the list.
Yes. Yeah, leading with the hands.
The second base, Madrigal quickly for out number one.
You know, and that's a great way to hit. You always want to stay inside the baseball. What it's doing is preparing you to go ahead and drive the fastball the other direction. Anything off speed, you hit back up the middle or you pull it, you're going to cut down on your strikeouts. We see it with Madrigal. We see it with the best hitters in baseball, making sure that they start with the hands and let that barrel lag behind. I don't know. It's not a new concept, but it's about can you execute it, and the best hitters that we've seen batting average wise do. Tim Anderson's a guy hits the ball up the middle the other way with frequency by leading with the hands first.
We've seen it so much this year, especially there are guys who are, as Castellanos stands in, there are guys who are, yes, looking almost exclusively for power, but there's now another class of player who says, based on the pitch, I'm looking for power, or I'm looking for the hit that they're going to give me.
I think you have to. You have to go ahead and concede. If you are facing a pitcher, Jason, that's not really going to challenge you with what you like as a strength, take a base hit. It's not complicated. Get your hits. And if you happen to respond to a mistake that they make, okay, then you take advantage of that just by reacting. But you got to have the base hit first approach against certain types of pitchers.
1-1 from Stever. Breaking ball in the dirt, 2 balls and a strike. Castellanos, we know him very well from his Tigers days. He has 12 home runs, that's second most on the Reds this year. The 55 strikeouts is the most on Cincinnati's team. On the corner, 2-2.
It's very kind of you to say on the corner.
Well, it was in the general vicinity of the corner.
Hey, look, you know, one of the things that we have been discussing, you and I, and talking about the strike zones this season, they have been a little inconsistent and pitcher friendly.
Castellanos lights this ball up to left field, and the Cincinnati Reds have taken the first lead in the series on the 13th home run from the former Tiger. And Sox fans are like, didn't he leave our division? Do we have to do this again?
Yeah, let's just talk about what we saw take place there. We talk about leading with the hands. Well, there it was. Castellanos likes to drive the ball the other direction and react to anything that's hanging down the middle of the plate. And this was a slider that was hanging right there down the middle of the plate for him to nail. Just a little flick of the barrel because the rest of the body was in place, and that ball goes a long way just a great swing from a powerful hitter.
He knew it when he got it.
Yeah, I think you just go ahead and call that the old no doubter.
He might be watching for another Ford home run replay.
Wants to see who comes next.
Yeah, it's Joey Votto here, who is really an entertaining guy to watch hit. It's time now for our American Family Insurance home field hero, and it's the home and road splits for Joey Votto. See 338 at home, 108 on the road, which is shocking because usually he hits and senses the strike zone anywhere and everywhere.
Well, he's got that tremendous career on base percentage and a lifetime 304 hitter. So if he's not hitting anywhere, it makes no sense.
Off speed for a strike, 1-2 on Joey Votto, who has said before, somebody asked him about his concept of the strike zone, and he basically said, I can just sense it. Like I just have, I can almost like taste the strike zone. He was talking about it as though like somebody who tastes colors. You know what I mean?
I don't trust anything he says.
You don't?
No. I've seen the antics of Joey Votto over the years dealing with the fans, and I think he's an amazing guy. I'm a fan personally.
Yeah, yeah.
I like the guy, but the things that he talks about, I definitely think he's just throwing it out there. As you see how that batting average has started to drop off, I'd like to see him come back to full strength.
Third base side, he's going to get a hit out of this thing on a cue shot down the left side.
Yeah, well, look at that reward by being completely fooled on an off-speed pitch. And there's the personality we're talking about with this guy. You know, he may come across sometimes to me as being a little standoffish when he's dealing with certain types of people. But I think he is that guy that kind of gives you that dry wit.
Mm-hmm.
And I like that. And obviously he's been a great player in his career. And we're hoping that in the next three games that this is the best hit that he picks up, nothing else.
He is he's eccentric for a baseball player, but I mean that in like a loving way. You know, people in the media say, hey, don't be bland when you talk to us. And then you get something and then you put it on a headline and you make fun of the guy for saying it for like 3 days in a row. Joey Votto is a treasure in terms of personality. He's different, and he's put together a marvelous career of a decade and a half now.
Well, absolutely. Now let's just eliminate him on a double play ball.
That sounds perfect. Eugenio Suarez is the home run leader for the Cincinnati Reds. He will strike out a bunch. He led the league in strikeouts last year, but a big time power bat.
Yeah, I've been trying to figure out where that come from. I know guys can grow with their powers, but this is crazy. We're talking about a guy that his first year with Detroit hit 4 home runs in limited play. And then his second year, first year with the Cincinnati Reds, he hits 13 home runs, jumps up to 21 home runs, 26, 34, and then last season, 49 home runs. Okay, who knew?
Yeah, huge numbers. I mean, especially the jump from the year before to last year as a check swing, he did not go, says James Hoy at first.
And I am a believer that when you find your home run swing, you can actually stay there for a long time, but 49 home runs is off the charts. That's big boy. That's, you know, the biggest guys in baseball type of power. So in a regular full season, I got to see if he can do that again.
Well, I'm going to be honest here. In 1990, young Darren Jackson hit 3 home runs. Then the following year, he hit 21 home runs. So you know something about a jump from year to year in home runs.
Well, 3 home runs because I had like 10 at bats.
Oh yeah, hang on. Let me check. Yeah, 58 games, 120 plate appearances. It was like 3 times the trips to the plate.
Yeah.
So you still way outperformed the year before.
Oh, absolutely.
So tell us how he did it. How'd you do it?
I just explained.
Uh-huh.
No, seriously.
Foul ball.
Seriously.
From Suarez.
My description of you can get locked in with the home run swing, that is it. That's the year I'm referring to where I hit those 21 home runs. Because my home run spot was there. It's a little box. You can see the ball in that spot, and it just stayed there for me all year long. I came back the next year with almost twice the same amount of at-bats and hit 17 home runs. It was gone.
Center field, Robert makes the catch. 2 down. So wait.
you were just getting on me for saying Joey Votto could sense the strike zone, and then you said your home run swing was in a little box that you could see all year long.
Right. Well, that's real. Joey stuff.
Oh, that's real.
Yeah.
I see.
Votto stuff is make-believe.
Okay.
Let me explain to you again, Jason.
Yeah, please.
What I say is right.
Uh-huh.
What you infer is not.
Oh, that's... Okay, it's easy, and
yes.
Now I've filed that away
all
in my
right.
brain. This is
now
great.
Now let's just continue on with the route we're going here. Just give the people what they want here.
Yeah, me being wrong. So you fit in perfectly, our telecast. Two out and a breaking ball popped up. First base side, foul territory. Abreu makes the catch. And so sad to say, this conversation will have to come to an end. We'll see if we pick it up next. We won't. Ron Vesely with some photos from around the ballpark. Nobody does it better than Ves.
You know, he's got photos of me, Jason, from back in the day as well.
Does he really?
Yes. Me and Joey Votto.
Yeah. It's a foul ball from Encarnacion. Your 21 home run season was with San Diego, so he's only got like a couple of home run ball snapshots, right?
All right, we're done with you.
You had to. You did it. You're 10 and 94.
Don't poke the bear. I was told early.
Uh-huh. Two strikes for Edwin, and that's down and out, one and two. So the pattern's pretty clear from Malley, is get ahead and then use that slider, try and put you away.
Yeah, you know what? It's a pattern that's worked for him, that's for sure. His numbers are better this year than any other season.
Strike three upstairs, one gone. Your 2020 Chicago White Sox are presented by Guaranteed Rate. Get a win at home with low rates and no curveballs. Visit rate.com today. Speaking of rates, Tyler Malley has a spin rate that is a very good one for his fastball. And a lot of pitchers are looking into their spin rates nowadays. And for a lot of people, they're just numbers on the page. But the one cool thing that StatCast can do is measure basically how much value you're getting out of your spin rate. Like a football spins, you want it to spin a certain way to add to the trajectory that you're looking to put on the ball. This is active spin on the fastball. So at 100%, all your spin is working to move the ball. So basically what that graphic says is he gets the most out of his fastball, or some of the most out of his fastball, than anybody in Major League Baseball.
Well, if we're going to have a stat like that, that's good to be at the top of the list.
You know, you have to know instinctively as a hitter, right, when a guy's fastball is moving well.
So, you know, we do have StatCast. We do have all the data now that tells you what's going on with the baseball and shifts and all of this. You know, it's no different than when we played without any of that, because we just used our eyeballs.
Yep.
And you talked about it. You said this guy's ball really runs, which is an indication that, okay, he probably has a little more spin on the ball. It's just now you can quantify it. You can say, this is why. And it's fun to talk about.
Yep.
But in the end, hitters are visualizing the baseball, where it's going to leave the pitcher's hand and where it's going to end up, and they got to get that barrel to that spot.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you, as this popped up by Moncada. Foul territory. A lot of foul ground there, and this is caught by Suarez for out number two. When you were dealing with a late-moving fastball, how did you handle it?
You hope that they couldn't throw it for a strike, number one, and you hope that you didn't chase. But the visualization, you know, I was talking about that box, which is real for me.
I get okay? it. I get it. My regular partner has a triangle on his glove, so crazy.
So that box, if you're locked in, you put it out there in a spot, and you say, if it's in this box, swing. If it starts out of that box, lay off, because it's going to end up where you can't hit it. That's your only hope.
So basically, you're just waiting for the ball to enter that spot for you.
You see the release out of the hand immediately. You see if it's in that box and where it's going to end up. But you have to visualize everything before it ever happens. I mean, the same thing defensively or anything. You know, it's not like you stand out there on the outfield or the infield and you go, are they going to hit the ball to me? Is we need this guy to visualize and get his swing back in Luis Robert as he takes a fastball down across the knees. But if he can find that spot, what a difference it's going to make for him to start turning things around for him offensively. Mm-hmm. it's gone right now for him. He just sees a big old huge field.
One ball and two strikes. You see any patterns in Luis's last maybe 10, 12 at bats?
No, what I've unfortunately seen with Luis is he went from the great perfect approach early in the year, keeping the left shoulder closed and driving it toward the pitcher, to where now it has a tendency to fly open toward the shortstop before he's actually committed to seeing the ball. He cheats. He doesn't have to, but he's just not comfortable right now.
To shortstop, and Garcia with a nice play for round number three. That's six in a row for Malley, and the Sox trail 1-0. News and notes. Healthy Luke Voit, we showed you in the RBI chase with Jose Abreu. 19 home runs last three games for the Yankees to play the Red Sox tonight. Shane Bieber was awesome at the Tigers once again. 7 2/3 and 10 strikeouts. And the Tampa Bay Rays, DJ, they are a very dangerous team. Short series, long series, they will match up with you better than anybody in baseball and play the angles, and they are going back to the postseason.
Honestly, I just keep trying to figure out how they do it. I look down there and I go, the Rays again? You know, in the past, very difficult division to be atop of. The Yankees, the Red Sox have always been those teams. But look, more power to them. They're a small market team that doesn't get any credit for what they do with their team, and they're winning.
Some really underappreciated guys are having some nice stretches, like Joey Wendell is having a very nice couple of weeks. Some guys that you just don't really know their names as household names, but they are fantastic players, and the pitching staff has been awesome. As this goes to the right side, and that's why you shift Madrigal for out number one. And time now for a word for your local Ford dealer.
We built Ford Super Duty, the most capable heavy-duty pickup ever. We built Ford F-150 with 375 horsepower and Ranger with the terrain management system. Because of this, you made Ford America's best-selling brand.
One down, Great American Ballpark. We thank you for joining us. Darren Jackson, Jason Benetti, our entire crew from the Queen City of Ohio, as the Reds have taken a lead on a solo home run from Nick Castellanos. And now the well-traveled Brian Goodwin, who we've seen with the Angels and the Nationals, now Cincinnati et al.
Yeah, and you know, I've noticed that he's kind of bounced around a little bit. Also played with Kansas City, I believe, briefly. And he's a guy that you look at and you say, okay, obviously there's some value there. He's trying to find a permanent home, permanent residence, and he's trying to put up some big numbers for this team contending for a playoff spot.
He's 29 years old out of Rocky Mount, North Carolina. Came up with the Nationals. He was one of their top prospects. First round pick in 2011, Brian Goodwin, and originally actually drafted by the Sox out of high school, didn't sign. And then went to Miami-Dade College and was a first round pick of the Nationals.
Yeah, and think about that. He's gone from the Nationals. He went briefly to Kansas City and the Angels last year, where he had good numbers. I mean, overall, 17 home runs, 262 batter, 29 doubles. So he's somebody that you look at if you're the Cincinnati Reds and you got a bit of a weakness. You don't have a left-handed bat that can drive the ball and cover the ground in the outfield. If somebody went down for you this year, and you go get him. And that's what they did. They said, we need a little help, and he might be the perfect fit. Doesn't have to be a star that helps you get over the hump.
Right. Breaking ball tipped foul. Brian Goodwin last year with the Angels had 29 doubles and 17 home runs. It was his best power season since 2017 when he had 21 doubles, 13 homers with the Nationals. There is some slug in that bat.
Yeah, and you know, we're fortunate we're not going to see it.
Look at you. How about that?
I'm here to help.
Yeah, you are. Two down on a ground ball to second.
Well, over in radio with Andy, you know, usually I have sitting there on the desk a crystal ball.
You do.
And it just occasionally tells me what's going to happen.
What does it do the other times?
The other times I put it underneath the desk and it stays angry at me and it doesn't help at all.
Very interesting. So, it seems moody.
Yeah, and well, kind of like some of my partners in the past.
Ooh.
Yeah. Not you, of course.
No, thank you, you know, so much.
This is game three for you and I, so you have been the perfect host every time.
To, Two down for Garcia. Native of Cuba, just 22 years old. In his first major league season, as Stever comes inside on him.
Well, he's the guy in their lineup that, as you just saw, will swing at a high percentage of first pitch. 71% of the time, which just went up this year, he has swung at the first pitch thrown to him. And that's up there. You've got somebody like Tucker Barnhart on deck that swings 56% of the time first pitch.
In the air right of center, and Robert waits for it to come down. Out number three, five in a row, retired by Stever. Looks similar to his last outing, 1-0. As per, it is the playoff picture in the American League. The Sox have the best record. That would be the one seed. Twins are in second place. They're playing the Cubs tonight at 3 games back. Wild card teams, the Indians and Blue Jays. And as we show you the possible playoff matchups in the first round, you see the Sox would play the Blue Jays right now. Tons of young talent in that prospective series, huh?
Yeah, and you know, I was looking at this and looking at the matchups, and I personally, if we were to play any of these teams today, I don't want to play the Blue Jays right now.
Really?
No.
Why not?
Because of what you just said. Tons of young talent that we really don't know that well, and you never know if they're going to be explosive that particular night. I'd like to go with the more predictable. If you got some veteran guys that are struggling, stay with those guys, like the Houston Astros. That's a team that maybe is not locked in right now.
Yeah, they're a scary team by name, but the pitching's not the same, the Astros.
Exactly.
With the injuries.
So that's why I kind of look at that and I go, right now, if I had my druthers, that would be the scenario.
Who else really scares you in the American League right now?
Well, it would have to be the Yankees.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah, because of what they're doing. They're getting healthy at the right time, getting the big boppers back in their lineup. And obviously, they've got enough pitching to where they're going to contend with anybody anyway. Yeah, they're legit, even if they're not at the top of the division.
3-0 to Mazzara. That's a strike from Malley. So Nomar Mazzara trying to get untracked. He had the day off yesterday, and Jerod Dyson played very well, actually, in his stead at 2-for-4 with a run scored, a couple of stolen bases.
Yeah, it was nice to see Jerod get that second start and contribute for the win yesterday. It's got to make him feel good.
3-2, Mazzara took a rip at a ball high.
One of the things that's been going on with Nomar for me is obviously we know what he's capable of doing. We've seen it in the past while he's playing with the Rangers. But his swing has basically been geared up of just getting base hits the other way. Mm. And I'm glad he's been able to keep his head above water, but he's not the power hitter that we know he can be.
Takes inside, nicely done, ball four. It's a leadoff walk. So we've started playing a game this year called Sox Files, hashtag Sox Files. We go deep into the file cabinet, and you have to guess who this player is in Sox history. First MLB hit was off his team's future general manager. He retired two future MVP winners in his lone career mound appearance, and he was drafted in the same round as John Elway. So if you know the answer, hashtag Sox Files on Twitter. Darren's thinking it over.
Well, I mean, those are really some crazy questions to have to answer.
Yeah, it's there are some very specific clues from Chris Kamka. Do you by chance know who it might be?
Me?
Yeah, do you
no,
know who
I
it is?
No idea.
You don't?
None whatsoever.
No clue?
Uh-uh.
Hmm. Are you just funning with me?
Maybe the John Elway gave it away.
You think?
I was drafted that same year.
Were you really?
Yeah, I can't even believe it.
Wow.
Yeah.
Surprising. What a coincidence.
Wait a minute. Now, think about it. Ed Lynch, I got my first big league hit off of, and, you know, he became a big league general manager.
Huh.
And he and I later became teammates. That's crazy.
Huh. How many times did you pitch in the big leagues?
You know what?
DJ?
I pitched against some pretty good players in the one outing when I pitched in Houston against guys like Caminiti and Bagwell. And yeah.
Huh.
I'm not sure who that guy was, though.
I don't know. We'll see. Hashtag Sox Files as Yolmer swings through a fastball for a strike, 2-1.
You know, I will say this. My particular pitching outing.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't do the typical guy goes out there and gets three outs and walks away. I said, no, send me back out there. I pitched 2 innings in one game.
Yeah, you didn't want the ERA zero thing.
Now you're digging too deep.
Three balls and a strike, and Sanchez with a good eye there. So Madrigal is next. Sox are down on a home run from Castellanos. And it is good to see Yomer Sanchez back. I mean, you got a Gold Glover sitting on your bench.
Yes, and at the expense right now of Danny Mendick, who did nothing wrong. But
right.
Obviously, when it comes to need at the time, sometimes you move somebody off your roster that didn't do anything wrong, but you just need to place it and set it right. Your roster as Yomer disagreeing with that last call. But again, we've had this strike zone all season long that is pretty unpredictable. And PitchCast says that's right at the top of the strike zone. And one of my bugaboos, Jason, is that bugs me more than most is that the high strike's not called enough. It bugs
really?
Me. Yeah. Because high pitches, if you're actually ready for them, guess what? They're really good hittable pitches rather than something sinking below your kneecaps.
3-2 struck him out. There's a high fastball. And one gone. All right. So here is the dramatic reveal of Sox Files. It is you, Darren Jackson.
You know, I could not believe the similarities. I couldn't believe that it actually could have been me. But yeah, I see it now.
What a coincidence.
Well, it better be put up that way. I told Chris how to put that together earlier today.
You did.
Yeah.
Hey,
Chris,
kind.
Make sure you get all these things
yeah.
here for me today.
So your first hit was off of Ed Lynch.
Yes, it was. Absolute missile into right center field.
Was it an actual missile or 20 years down the road it was a missile?
The fish is a lot bigger now. Okay?
That's what I figured,
than
yeah.
when I first caught it, yes.
One down for Madrigal. Runner goes, throw down to second base, and out at second.
Yeah, you might see the White Sox take a few more risks than they would have recently because they've already clinched a postseason spot, but this is not one where you really start, I think, tinkering, sending guys like Mazzara is not really the fastest of guys. I'm going with that was more along the lines of a hit and run, and you see right there the head looking in by Mazzara, which is an indication that it was probably a hit and run, and it was a slider down the way, and Madrigal, he couldn't stay on the pitch, pulled off of it.
It looked like, as Madrigal goes down, it looked like the run of a hit and run, too. He was not full go stolen base mode, don't you think?
Well, everything right there gave it away because Nick's not going to usually bend over at the waist and swing at a slider knee high down in the way unless he's trying to protect the runner. And he's probably standing there going, really? You throw me that pitch then of all the pitches? So, yeah, it was that.
Strike three up in the zone. The fastball from Malley. We'll go bottom three, 1-0.
The Capital One unique performer as we talk about the pitching staff for your Chicago White Sox. You see the ERA. They are third in all of baseball. This is a very good pitching staff. Opponents batting average fifth best at 226. Inherited runners third and first in home runs given up per nine innings. And, you know, this has been a pitching staff that we know since after the first week of the season, Jason, has really settled in because we could not believe when this season started how the Minnesota Twins just hammered on Lucas Giolito and then they teed off on some other guys after that. And it took them quite some time to just start whittling that ERA that started at 9 down to where it is, tremendous 3.45.
You know, you stop and you think, hey, what if you're a casual baseball fan? You tuned in for the first three games of the year and then you jump in like 30 days later. You'd say, well, how did that happen? Because that first four games, three against Minnesota, one against Cleveland, first five games, really, as that ball's down the line at Fallow and two, it looks like a totally different ball club that we're seeing right now.
You know, and that just to me shows the dedication of the pitching staff going out and correcting things that were incorrect. And they did it quickly. But it was a long, hard road to get that ERA where it is now.
Tucker Barnhart on two strikes sends it up and out of here. And Brownsburg's finest makes it 2-0 Cincinnati.
You know, another lead with the hands swing on a pitch that was up and in. You know how easy it is to get that barrel out and around and hook that foul, but he did not. He led with the hands and ended up keeping that ball fair inside that foul pole. And showing lots of skill and talent. A 207 hitter coming into that at bat shows that he's got what it takes. Pitch was supposed to be on the outside part of the plate, though, Jason, and drifted over the inner part where he was looking for it.
So 2-0 Cincinnati, and here is Akiyama, who takes strike one. Ground ball to second for Akiyama, who is one of the rare ground ball hitters on this Cincinnati team. We showed you the ground balls that the Sox pitching staff has put together, not allowing the home run ball nearly as much as the beginning of the year. This will be an interesting series because the Reds are the number one team in fly ball percentage in baseball. They like to lift. There are some teams in baseball, they really do seek lift, you know, on the ball above all.
Well, I was looking at some of the numbers you're mentioning earlier this today. I was looking at the fact that Akiyama is a guy that I think it was close to 70% of the time or so hits the ball ground ball or line drive. Mm-hmm. But he does not lift. And I looked at his numbers in Japan for the Cebu Lions, and he had a season where he had, I believe, 27 home runs, 25. So he's kind of changed his approach mm-hmm. to kind of settle in to America and be a ground ball hitter. And I think I've seen that in the past. You know, Hideki Matsuyama for the New York Yankees.
Matsui, yeah.
Matsui, that is. He is a guy that in Japan hit nothing but 40-plus home runs every year, and then he settled for 25 a year when he got here.
That's right.
Because he wanted to hit for more average. So he changed his approach and his swing, so it's not unusual. Hideki Arabu, the pitcher that came from Japan, he changed his way of pitching. Everybody was getting on Montreal when they brought him over here and go, what kind of guy is this? He went to the Yankees. He lost his curveball. He didn't throw it at all, and it was his out pitch in Japan.
This on the ground. And out number one for Sanchez. Test your luck during every White Sox game this season with the 50-50 raffles. Sox Split, presented by Wintrust, on sale now until the end of the seventh inning. Current jackpot estimated right around $300 and growing throughout the course of the telecast. Get your Split the Pot 50-50 tickets at whitesox.com/SoxSplit, valid for Illinois residents 18 and over. One down for Castellanos, and you're talking about how Akiyama's changed his game, and he sort of provides balance for this team, kind of like Nick Madrigal does for the Sox. A lot of power bats in the lineup, and Madrigal is that contact hitter that glows in the bottom of the order and now number one today.
Well, you're right. It does kind of add that different element to your lineup, but truth be told, if Nick Madrigal can hit home runs like Jose Altuve, they'd be happy with that fact as well.
That's right. So that's right.
He is the type of player he is, but he is that nice balance and know that you got a contact hitter there. You see the swing right there by Castellanos. He's somebody that still tries to stay inside the ball. Fastball's the other direction. Tying him up nicely with that sinking fastball at 91 miles an hour. But hopefully we've learned from our mistake and we don't hang him a slider that he can absolutely crush and hit another home run, because that's what ultimately he's looking to do.
I was a little shy.
Ouch. Yeah, that's making sure you don't make a mistake on the 0-2 pitch. And there's a young man, Jonathan Stever. Good look at him. You look at the high school football stats. D-back, wide receiver.
Yeah, he was. He was a great football player.
Yes.
First team All-State.
Absolutely. What about you? What other sports did you excel in other than baseball?
On video games, just about everyone. Castellanos in the air to left field, and Eloy Jimenez. Before we get to my sports highlights, which will come in like the 50th inning, here's Jonathan Stever. Let's go back to his high school career. Wide receiver, defensive back. And he could go up and get it. Some good ball skills as a DB, some good ball skills as a receiver. How about that?
Yeah, absolutely, showing what he's capable of doing. And he's got to give the quarterback all the credit, but it was just him. He's just say, throw it to me, I'll get up to it, just like Randy Moss would.
Look at the space he created with every step there, by the way. That was a runaway. How many sports did you play growing up?
All of them.
You did?
Yep. I was probably, my second best sport would have probably been ping pong.
Oh, was that right?
Yeah.
How come everybody I work with here is a good table tennis player?
I don't know about the others, Jason, but
yeah,
I know I'm legit.
All right.
Yeah.
We should find a table and play at a distance.
No, I'm okay right now. I got a bad hand.
Ooh.
Yeah. My hand's bothering me right now, but maybe in the distant future we can work it out.
Some days we all get dealt a bad hand.
Well, mine's going to be around for a while.
1-1 to Votto. That is off the plate outside. Two balls and a strike on Joey Votto, and you're talking about swing percentage. He is very low. 37% of the time only does he swing at the pitch delivered to him.
Oh, a career 400 plus on base percentage.
In the air, center field, Robert watches it fly and it's gone. Joey Votto hits the third solo home run for Cincinnati tonight.
Well, that is a hitter's heaven, that ballpark. We know it. Ball jumps out of there. Great place to hit. You know, not that we have a place that's something you sneeze at. This is a good hitter's ballpark as well. But unfortunately, it looked like that might have been a changeup that he left out where Votto can extend his arms. Absolutely yak-a-towed that ball out of here to center field. Got that high leg kick. You know, you don't see many guys that go with a high leg kick like that anymore. And I'm a big fan of the leg kick. You can adjust to the slower pitches. You know, you just glide forward on the slower stuff, get it down quicker on the fastballs.
Sort of a timing mechanism for you?
Well, I just think it really works for a lot of hitters and you create a little more power with it. Not the case for all guys. Obviously, anybody like Suarez here has got less of a leg kick. Works for him. He hit 49 home runs last season.
Two balls, no strikes. Sox have allowed three home runs now in three straight ball games, which is something that was certainly not happening
right
at the beginning of this winning stretch.
Well, the focus has to remain high right now till the end of the season. But one of the things we are seeing also, Jason, is we're seeing some of our starters right now that are out of the rotation. We're getting guys like Lopez back in there, which is good to see him back on top of his game, which is key. We've got to get the ball where it's supposed to be. That's the key. Locate the pitch where it's supposed to be. We're leaving too many out over the plate.
I think Don Cooper and or Ricky Renteria were getting on the plate umpire Mark Carlson for one of those ball calls, and there is ball four for Suarez. First walk for Cincinnati in the ball game, and here comes Coop.
Well, what we learned in the first outing for Jonathan Stever is that once he settled down, he really located well. And he retired the nine straight batters before he was yanked out of the ball game. But what we know is he's capable of getting it back together. So he can give up a couple of home runs in an inning like this. Solo shots, it doesn't hurt you. You're just down 3-0. But right now is where you got to stop the bleeding. This is the time where you got to get that third out. That's why I think this is a great meeting to have. Get him focused back and let him know, hey, it's not that tough. You can do this.
He will face Mike Moustakas after this. The Sox are in. Now be in for 2021. Reserve your spot to catch all the action live with a ticket package and get postseason priority for the 2021 season. Call or text SoxTix 312-674-1000 or visit WhiteSox.com today. DJ, the thing that strikes me about that graphic we just saw is when people nationally are jumping in and learning about the White Sox, they say, okay, who's the leader? Who's the person who makes this team go? Kind of feels like it's somebody new every night when the team's playing well, as you said in the open.
Well, I agree. I mean, I think the contributions from any individual any night really jump forward, and you talk about that guy in that situation, but you know who the team leader is. Everybody's already spoken about it. The soft-spoken Jose Abreu is the guy that leads this team, but he doesn't have to be the guy that carries the team. That's the good news.
1-0 from Stever, and that's off speed away. It's two balls, no strikes on Mike Moustakas.
Moustakas is a guy we've known for so many years, but in the end, he's trying to get a pitch to hook out of this ballpark. And he'll take something away and hook it or anything in, and he'll get to it.
3-0.
I'll go with the meeting they just had was don't throw him a fastball.
Hey, I'm going to guess you're right.
Three straight changeups out of the strike zone.
Swinging 3-0 here?
Absolutely.
Not at that. Upstairs, ball four. Back-to-back walks. And now you got to think about the Sox not having an off day until the playoffs.
Yeah, that's why you give a Tim Anderson a night off like this. You're going to have to pick your moments if you're the manager of the White Sox and make sure that everybody does feel like they've had a day off going into the postseason. But in the end, you got to remember it's ultra important for this team to be the division leaders. You're three games up in Minnesota here in the division. You don't want to give that back. So these games all mean something to the White Sox. It's not like you say, oh, let's give a few guys a day off. We can afford to lose a game. That's just not the case.
Sox are three up right now in the AL Central on Minnesota. Holding the tiebreaker over the Twins after the win yesterday as Stever misses with a breaking ball and trying to find his command in a hurry.
Well, it seems like we're getting a bit of the reverse of his first start as he settled in nicely. Now he seems to be a little rattled as they have hit the ball hard off of him three times in the game now. And he might be trying to prevent contact, which is never a good thing.
There for a strike, one ball, one strike on Jesse Winker, who hit 16 home runs last year. He's got 10 this year, but none this month.
Yeah, he caught fire and he hit those 10 home runs basically, it seemed like, in a week.
Mm-hmm.
He just kept hitting them. But, you know, he doesn't have a long history of being a power hitter. He's just a guy with power.
Winker tattoos this ball. And the Reds have home run number 4 in the ball game. It is 6-0 Cincinnati.
And he didn't have any problem running into that one. Appeared to be a hanging slider. I mean, when I say hanging, right at the top of the strike zone, and he saw that out of the hand and absolutely murdered that baseball. So Winker, who had you just mentioned, had not been hitting any bombs, got the pitch that was put on a tee to his liking, and he got all that back pocket into it.
Grounds crew loved it down the first base line, that's for sure.
Yeah, well, you know, again, it's one where you didn't want this one to get out of hand, but it is what it is. Yeah, these Cincinnati Reds have opened this one up.
So Ricky Renteria is coming out to the mound. Your Ford home run replay has Cincinnati up 6-0, and Jonathan Stever's second career start has come to an end. So the Sox, I believe you would say, have some work to do as they go into the bullpen early.
On his way out to the season, 8 games, 1 win, 1 loss, a 4.61 ERA as Gio comes in with a clean slate, nobody on base, so he's going to be out there pretty comfortable, I would imagine, not feeling any heat, any pressure. He just needs to get one out here on this third base quickly against Brian Goodwin, the left-hander. And then we can expect him to come on out and maybe hopefully give us a few innings.
Yeah, pick up. You would think Ricky Renteria would look for upwards of 7 to 10 outs from Gio Gonzalez today.
I was hoping you'd say 7 to 10 innings, carry on till tomorrow. But yeah, 7 to 10 outs would work, you know, that'd be great.
You take it. Brian Goodwin first against Gio, and his first pitch is there for a strike. So tough one for Jonathan Stever with 4 home runs. And Cincinnati, we mentioned, they're not a great batting average team at all, but they're top 7 in baseball in home runs, and they will hurt you if you walk them.
Well, and they draw a lot of walks. That's the one thing that team does extremely well. You could throw the batting average out. They have an on-base percentage 100 points higher coming in than their batting average. And if you look at that collectively, if they came in with any decent batting average at 250 even, and you put 100 points on top of that as a club, that 350, that'd be the best in baseball. So they are getting on.
Goodwin to center, and Robert is there. So this late scoring offense is going to need to put up a big number today. It's available 6-0 after 3. By the left fielder's letters in his last name that game, plus the ending first baseman minus the catcher. So there's your Sox math question. And DJ, Mike didn't know that you were going to be here today when he said that, but that's a pretty neat video for the day you're here.
Well, you're not kidding. I mean, that is something that to me, I still hear it ringing in my ears every game that we do.
Yasmani center field and out number one. Your partner touched a lot of people in his time here and his time on the planet, and one of the most generous human beings with his time and his booth and his heart that we've all ever met.
Yeah. You know the word to me that describes Ed better than any? Memorable. You just never forget him. If you met Ed Farmer, and as many people as he met every single day, because he was not afraid to walk up to a stranger down the street and go, "Hi, I'm Ed Farmer." And immediately they go, "I'll remember this guy forever." He was the most memorable guy you could ever meet. And he already described all the other qualities. I mean, you know, the most generous person ever.
Yeah. Well, we all miss him dearly. And what I would give to hear his story about Ben McDonald and Scott and him.
Well, I can tell you, I know it by heart. Did I tell you about the time that his mom wanted to give me some squirrel soup?
And he had like a reptile in the bathtub,
right?
Oh,
it was a gator.
Yeah.
He had a gator down there in the bathtub spring training one year. And I had to go in there and tell him. Yeah, Ed had to go in and tell Ben McDonald, "Ben, you can't have that gator in the bathtub." It's like, why not? It was over there in the pond right by the hotel. So, and I've heard Ben tell the story as well.
Me
what
too,
a great
yeah.
guy. Oh, Ben McDonald is a great guy too, man.
Yeah, one of the best.
Yeah, so absolutely. Ed is somebody that fortunately I was able to spend 11 years in a booth with him.
Yeah.
And a lot longer. We were friends since 1994 when I first joined the White Sox. So a big loss, but a great season that he's looking down upon.
Yeah. Unquestionably. Mike Cannella, thank you for sending that video. That was pretty awesome, actually.
Yeah, that is perfect timing.
Really cool.
You're right. Huh? I'm like, wait a minute. This is a setup. They did this just for me.
He literally had no idea. Isn't that cool?
That is awesome.
Ball and two strikes on Jose from Malley, who's pitched very well in this game. One hit, one walk, and five strikeouts. And this to the right-hand side and foul.
Well, unfortunately, we're not getting the results to this point. A lot of baseball left. We're in the fourth inning with one out for this White Sox offense that obviously is very explosive. But Malley seems to be pretty settled in with just giving up the one hit and walk to go with five strikeouts. So the key is get him off the mound. Have a big inning right here.
Upstairs, 2-2. And just as a prelude to something coming on this telecast, I was told by our producer, Chris Withers, that we're doing the nationwide read in a moment. And so, you know, Stoney and I typically sing the nationwide read, and I would prefer not to do it alone tonight. So if you're willing to join in and sing, that would be a very nice thing.
Yeah, I might be able to join you. Yeah.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Yeah. How about that? How about right here? You're looking at Follow Our Sox Insider, Adam Hogue at NBCSports.com, NBCSportsChicago.com, presented by Nationwide agent Jeff Vukovich. Get to enjoy knowing the Vuk as much as you do the jingle at JeffVuk.com.
Because
Nationwide is on your side.
Yes.
Nice. You like how we have the pitch pipe working? As there's a base hit into left field, that's a knock for Eloy Jimenez, who jarred the camera while he was at it. It's a two-out single.
Hey, man, I feel like I'm part of the band now.
That was very well done. For a first time, our duet getting together.
Well, I'm going to say, it was all that pregame practice that we did, you know, making sure that we had the bagpipes in here to get us coordinated. So that worked out perfect.
Nothing better than socially distanced bagpipes. That's what I always say.
Oh, my.
Now, look, this offense, it's 6-0, right? It's 6-0 in the fourth inning. You turn it on and you say, well, you know, I don't know if the Sox are coming. This is the type of team that very suddenly it becomes 6-5 with a couple of swings.
Well, you know what I look at, and obviously in games like this, everybody knows it's a baseball fan. And people that are looking in are baseball fans. Is it's 6-0, it's early. But you can't let Cincinnati score anymore. So it comes down to the pitching and the defense making the play so your offense can feel like they can get back in it. I look at Encarnacion. Here's a guy that, you know, even though you look at the 172 batting average coming in, how big have some of his home runs been? I mean, they have been just when you need him to step up and deliver. It's like he reaches back into the history bag and all of a sudden says, I've got this, and he delivers. And it hasn't been in situations like this. It's actually been in closer game situations when you needed it.
kind of get the feeling that in the postseason, there's a different Edwin still around there, and he does provide that fearsome look in one spot in your batting order that pitchers around the league know.
Yeah, and you know what? I think you just hit on something that the pitchers know, because he has such an amazing history that you can't just go, oh, there's Edwin, let me just get him out, because you never know if he's picked that moment to sit on a pitch, which he did yesterday, hitting the home run, finally got the slider he was looking for and crushed it out of here.
Malley pitched him away the entire at bat and strikes him out, and the inning's over. We'll go bottom four. Home runs, opponents 41, a very patriotic spray chart. Fourth most in Major League Baseball in terms of ballpark home runs, but the question kind of is which came first, the chicken or the Reds here, because they hit a lot of fly balls and they do it intentionally, so they kind of play to their ballpark.
You know, I agree, you know, but it takes a special manager and pitching coach to say, hey, look, we're building a roster that can lift and separate because our ballpark says we should.
Right.
I would assume that you're telling your players to be good hitters first. And if it happens to go out of the ballpark, there you go.
Right, right. But you see the fly ball right there. And,
yes.
And again, like it's did they build for that, or did they happen to have it? Or in this era, are they just one of many teams who hit a lot of fly balls?
Well, I think you just hit the nail on the head there. I think there's a lot more teams that are trying to elevate the ball. I think, you know, data shows that percentage wise, you're more successful elevating the ball.
Mm-hmm.
And I've never, ever really thought about that.
You were playing, you're saying?
Well, it was always about line drives, hard ground balls, line drives, keep the ball out of the air.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you look at 100 fly balls that an individual hits, how many are going to actually land without being caught? Not many.
That's right.
So hit the ball hard, make them have to make a play was always the saying. Make them have to make a play. Fly balls is not really making a play if you're just kind of running underneath it and making a routine catch. That's easy in most cases.
It's part of the reason you don't see the hit and run as much anymore, because there are fewer guys who, as that is left side and a base hit, used to stand behind the batting cage and the hitting coach would say, okay, hit and run, and then you'd want to put the ball on the ground.
Oh, absolutely. That was the key. You were really teaching that. And all of a sudden, yeah, the game has changed. And I'll tell you, there's a lot of great players that do not agree with that approach. And along with the Frank Thomases, the Jim Tomes, all these guys kind of look at it and go, yeah, I don't know where people are coming up with this. You know, the angle needs to be up towards the sky to make contact, because that's not what they did, and it worked out pretty well for them.
One on, nobody out, Tucker Barnhart, the batter. Former Indiana Mr. Baseball from the Indianapolis area and Brownsburg High School, which has provided a bunch of major leaguers. He was high school teammates with Drew Storen. Lance Lynn, also from Brownsburg, Indiana.
How about that? That's a little bit of talent coming out of there, right?
Yeah, it is. We got a lot of Sox fans in Indiana.
Well, Indiana obviously has been a great hotbed for basketball players.
Yeah, if you don't grow up with a basketball hoop in your driveway, you're doing it wrong in Indiana, that's for sure.
Well, obviously, we're talking about a state that's actually put so many tremendous athletes out there anyway. I don't know if it matches what Illinois has done, but still.
Swing and a miss for strike three. First strikeout for Sox pitching tonight.
And check out our AT&T FirstNet Frontline Heroes of NBC on NBCSportsChicago.com. Chicago's finest are surprised by their favorite athletes, including AJ Pierzynski, Tony Kukoc, Joe Creedy, and Alex DeBrincat. And obviously that would be awesome to have any of those athletes surprise you, as I don't know if my favorite would probably be Joe Creedy.
Yeah. Runner goes from first and will get there as the ball bounced away. So Garcia up to second base after his single, then the wild pitch.
And I'm not throwing anybody else under the bus of those names, but the truth is, Joe Creedy to me was one of the most tremendous players we had when it came to playing third base and delivering in the clutch. Mm-hmm. Back in the day. What a great baseball player. And unfortunately, his career, you know, didn't finish out the way he wanted because he had to deal with a bad back. But what a great guy.
What was Joe Creedy like as a guy?
I mean, as friendly as can be, as blue collar as can be. You might have thought he was a hockey player.
I've heard that from a bunch of people now. Just blue collar, good, salt of the earth dude.
You know, most hockey players I've ever met, that is, are guys that you come across and you go, like, wait a minute. This guy's an actual star athlete, and he's just sitting down with his feet up going, hey, what's going on? Join me. Have a conversation. That's Joe Creedy. Just very reserved, very laid back, and open to conversation and friendship. Just somebody I really enjoyed being around.
Wave and a miss. 2-1 for Akiyama.
I'm looking at Akiyama, and you already described that first move of his with his swing, but also very difficult when they face a left-hander with breaking stuff like this for them to keep that shoulder on there. They are falling toward first base, pulling off the pitch.
This sneaks through, and it clipped the runner.
Yes, it did.
It clipped Garcia. We saw it a couple years ago with Troy Tulowitzki ending a game at Rogers Center. Sanchez is laughing at him because he just got popped on his way from second to third, so he's going to be out.
Yes, yes, he is. I don't know exactly what you're looking at when the ball's coming right at you, why you would not know, hey, might be my job to avoid letting the ball hit me. But it actually took him down. It clipped his wings right there. And man down.
Yeah, he popped a tire and went squirrely into the wall.
Oh, my. All right, then.
So Garcia's out. Akiyama to first base. And you got to know, right? I mean, if we know Akiyama's ground ball rate, his teammates have to know his ground ball rate.
Well, you would think so. I mean, I don't know. He put his head down and started running like, oh, the ball's hit. I got to go. Forget where it's going. It's irrelevant to me. Oh, what do you mean it hit me in the foot? What hit me?
Yeah, what was that? I step on a pebble?
I can honestly say all the years that I played minor league baseball, I was never hit by a baseball in the base pass.
Ever?
Ever. I mean, my goal in baseball was to always make sure the ball didn't hit me anywhere, in the batter's box or anywhere else.
That's right.
I for sure wasn't going to let it hit me on the base pass. It was like dodgeball. You got no chance.
I mean, can you imagine the first thought of Garcia at second base? What's going on?
Yeah. Oh, I can imagine. He had to literally be laying there going, okay, what hit me? Because he didn't know. Otherwise, he'd have moved his foot. And he went back, and he's a youngster. He's a youngster going to go back over there, and they're going to have to explain to him, you do know you're not supposed to let that happen.
Yeah, they're going to explain it to him when they're done laughing at him.
Yes.
There's strike three, and the inning's over for the Reds and Garcia. 6-0 after four. For today, Jim Thome was the DH, 5 × 4 + 7 - 10. Pierzynski was the catcher. Nick Swisher was the first baseman by the end of the game. GF Clark, 89, is your winner. 17 is your Sox math answer for today. Congratulations. You will get to do the video tomorrow. Going to be tough to top Mike Canella's video from earlier, who is no longer the villain of Sox math. He just won all the time. And a 6-0 score. Sox are trailing, and it's Yoan Moncada to lead it off. And the second time through the order has gotten the Sox just the Eloy Jimenez single.
Well, at this point, you're hoping there's not a bit of a hangover from that victory yesterday and clinching a playoff berth. A very reserved celebration from the Sox yesterday. And you really would think that they'd come here ready to win these games.
Yeah, it's an interesting day, right? Because Sox fans were talking all day long about, like, do you celebrate it that hard, or is there more to play for and all that. To me, and I want to see what you think about it, 2020, there's been so much bad in the world. Enjoy the heck out of any day you can enjoy, for me.
Well, no, I agree 100% with that. And the thing is, the reserve celebration yesterday by the Sox after winning kind of told me to them they've got a lot of baseball left to win.
Mm-hmm.
It's not, all right, we're there, we're going to set up the postseason. No, no, we want to win tomorrow, the next day, and every day after that. So they came in here today, to me, ready to play. It's just not turning out that way. And it has a lot to do with the fact that, unfortunately, Jonathan Stever did not have the performance that you were hoping that he would. But it's time for this offense to figure out what to do against Malley, because he is challenging them with that moving fastball, but that's a pitch that's hittable when you're sitting on it.
0-2, high fastball, well upstairs. One ball, two strikes. Fastball off the plate. Barnhart tried to get it for him.
Yeah, and, you know, we have had some umpires call that a strike not too infrequently. They have extended the strike zone, and it has led to a lot of dissension, let's say that.
Well, I got to say, Mark Carlson has had a very nice night so far.
I agree. Yeah, crew chief of this group, and he's doing his job, that's for sure. He's making the pitcher throw pitches that are actually close to what should be called a strike. You want the consistency, and we're getting that from Carlson right now.
Do have to say the umpires have a very difficult job, and when things like Josh Donaldson happened yesterday, nobody needs that in their lives. 2-2 off the plate, 3-2.
I needed it. It was very entertaining.
Well,
for me.
Yeah, you can. From a distance, certainly.
Oh, yeah. Well, the guys working down there definitely don't need it. You're right. But from a viewer standpoint, it's like, hey, that's entertainment.
Yeah, that's some good stuff right there. 3-2, and he struck him out. Pinpoint accuracy down and away, and the eighth strikeout for Malley.
Hey, White Sox fans, the Xfinity Sports Zone is the ultimate hub for all things sports, all in one place. With the Xfinity Sports Zone, everybody wins.
That's the way to do it. Everybody wins.
Yeah, well, tonight we're hoping that the guys in gray turn things around. Look, in the end, I don't like to go with the cliche, let's give him a finish. I don't want to have to use that tonight.
You don't?
No.
You kind of maybe just said it. Maybe.
No. I just inferred. Oh, I'm not going to say it when it's important late. No.
So you're not officially using it right now. You're
just
suggesting that maybe later if it got bad.
No, I'm just saying right now you can't use that in the fifth anyway.
No, you wouldn't dare do that.
It's way too early.
Want to know Juan Pizarro, who walked.
Give him a finish is in the eighth and ninth.
Sox have been very good at that. Late runs have been the way to go for the Sox offense.
Yeah, you know, I think when you really try and break down, even if you look at, they've scored more runs than anybody, seventh, eighth, and ninth inning, you could say all these things positive, but it's really been a balance. They do whatever it takes to win in whatever inning.
Yeah, you look at what the Sox have done when certain guys do two-hit games or when certain guys score a run like Tim Anderson, and obviously he has been a major catalyst to this team, and there have been better numbers for certain guys in certain situations, but overall this is a deep offense that picks each other up on a nightly basis.
And it's just fun to sit on the edge of your seat and wonder who's going to be the guy. You know, you expect Anderson to go ahead and do what he's doing and some of the other guys to the big part of the lineup, but what guy is going to kind of come out of nowhere and have the big hit? And this guy standing at the home plate, Nomar Mazara, has not really figured out his swing. He's not done a whole lot of exciting things, but I can think back to a big two RBI base hit when the White Sox needed two runs batted in. He did it. He pulled one into right center field in a tight game situation. So even he has stepped up offensively when it was really needed.
3-2, left-hand side. That's a base hit for Nomar Mazara. So twice on base for Nomar this evening in Cincinnati.
And it's not what you would expect from Mazara, to be a guy that's an opposite field singles hitter. But basically that's what he's had to stick with to be somewhat successful. The power swing, turning on the ball's just not been there for him for whatever reason. But I do like that he's accepting that he has to do whatever it takes to still keep his head above water and get a hit here and there. Show some maturity, that's for sure.
Well, there's just not a lot of time in a 60-game season. There are a lot of guys on the Sox who figured it out early and have just ridden that wave.
Right.
When you're not that guy, the 60-game season can be crushing.
Well, the only thing that matters is you help your team win.
Oh, Sanchez to right field, and this ball diving into the glove of Castellanos, who makes the play to thwart a possible rally as the Sox still trail after 4.5. Great American Ballpark as the Sox trail with Votto, Suarez, and Moustakas coming up. You miss Riverfront Stadium, DJ?
No.
You don't?
No.
It was so lovely.
Cookie cutter, very basic. Not at all.
No. Another one of those that when it was hot out, the turf felt like it was a million degrees, right?
Oh, yeah, but not so much as at Busch Stadium or at Royals Kauffman
yeah.
Stadium. No, those were the places.
Where was the worst turf? The Vet?
It was up there, but Montreal.
Was it?
Yeah, Olympic Stadium was the worst.
All right, so after this pitch, tell us how bad it was at Olympic Stadium to play on AstroTurf.
Basically, you stand on the very thin layer of AstroTurf and then cement underneath it.
Oof. Yikes.
Yeah.
Not good on the knees, right?
No. Fortunately for me, being very young at the time I played on that stuff, it didn't bother me. But it was rough because there are going to be times, as you well know, you got to leave your feet. And when you leave your feet and land on that stuff, I mean, you might as well go out on the sidewalk and run full speed and take a dive. Difference is you get up with carpet burn after the fact.
Votto might have hurt his wrist on that swing. Sort of an awkward swing. He's gripping his hand. Watch this thing. Sort of aborted mission mid-swing, DJ.
Well, let's just say he didn't help his cause by swinging at a pitch that almost hit him in the thigh. You know, I always say if you're going to swing at a pitch like that, don't show any pain after the fact. You're going to have to live with whatever embarrassment follows.
Yeah, but have enough pride to realize that you were defending yourself and all that.
Okay.
1-2, and Votto spoils it foul. Joey Votto does not pop the ball up very much, and he certainly, whoa, track star groundskeeper goes. Joey Votto has one pop up to first base since his major league debut. There have been 6 perfect games, 5 4 straight home run games in Major League Baseball since Joey Votto debuted. He has one pop up to first base. 2 unassisted triple plays, 1 Joey Votto pop up to first.
That's digging real deep. I mean, to find that. Put that work in to find the one pop up to first base. I'm proud of you. Is that Chris?
It was Chris Kampka. Yeah, it's very Kampka-esque. There's strike 3. Votto goes down. And now time to check in the studio. Get a sneak peek of what's coming up on White Sox Postgame Live presented by Subaru. Chuck Garfine with Adam Hoag, who hears his name without a flat jingle. Chuck, thank you so much. And we may have a major league debut tonight. Garrett Crochet called up from the Schaumburg facility in the same year that he was drafted in the first round out of Tennessee. So Garrett is out there in the bullpen as Evan Marshall's dealing with some shoulder inflammation. And so Crochet up from Schaumburg.
You know, and if we put the research in, Chris, when's the last time a guy went straight from college to the big leagues?
You know what? We've already put that research in.
There we go.
John Olerud's on that list, right?
John Olerud, yeah, John he Olerud. Would be, yeah. But that's the thing. It just doesn't happen enough. A lot of people forget Chris Sale. They all think he came straight from college to the big leagues. He actually pitched some in the minor leagues before getting here.
He did a little bit on Florida Gulf Coast to the minors and then here to the bullpen and then to the starting rotation.
And a lot of people thought that they would have preferred to keep him in a closer's role and be one of the most dominant closers ever. But I like the fact he became a starter.
Mm-hmm. More innings for you there. There's strike 3. Top of the zone for Suarez.
Yeah, fastball from Gio. He gets so many hitters sitting on the off-speed stuff because he uses it so frequently that when he sneaks that fastball in there, even if it's just 90 miles an hour, 91 miles an hour, they're just not ready for it.
Mm-hmm. You know, one guy who went straight to the majors from college that you wouldn't necessarily expect because of everything that he went through to become a major league pitcher is Jim Abbott.
Yes. I got a nice Jim Abbott story. If I can get it in here, I'll tell you.
Yeah, you did. Two out. If we get halfway through, we'll wait for the break.
So when he first signed with the Angels and was just getting to big league camp, I said, this guy's throwing one hand. He can't feel his position.
Yeah.
I'm bunting.
Did you really?
Yeah. I said, forget that. He's here. I'm bunting.
What happened to you?
He threw me out.
Of course he did.
No. Actually, what happened was I push bunt. He's a lefty, so I push bunt. He had to get off the mound, flip the glove around, field, and throw. And I was safe at first base, but they missed the call. I would have been out.
Is that right?
Yes.
Well, I mean, that's the thing about Jim Abbott's career. He's a wonderful guy, first of all.
Yes.
You got to know him, right?
Yes.
What he went through to not have two full arms and to use two full hands and to not have the ability to field like normal. He'd put the glove on the one hand and then flip it around after he threw. I mean, it's a truly remarkable story of somebody overcoming so much, but nobody's going to feel sorry for you. Like, you didn't go up there saying, well, you know, because he might struggle to field, I think maybe I won't bunt. You said, let's see what can happen. He's tough as nails, that dude.
Well, the thing is, you just described it. It was that made me do it. I go, hey, he's here. There's no handicap involved.
Right.
So let's make him field his position, boys. Let's find out what he can do. Of course, I went back after that and said, well, obviously, he can field his position, guys. So now we know.
One on, two out. And there is a strike after the walk to Moustakas. So Winker, who had the big home run in this game, a three-run shot. I wish they would have called you out on that bunt, by the way. It would have served you right.
I honestly would have preferred it because I would have gone back saying, all right, yeah, this guy can play.
Were you teammates together with the Sox?
No,
we didn't overlap. I didn't think
we were not. But obviously I've had conversations with him over the years just on the field. And like you said, just a great guy.
One, one. Two balls and a strike.
And one of the big things, moments in my life was I finally hit a home run in old Yankee Stadium. Like all the older stadiums, you want to hit a home run, say that you did it.
Uh-huh.
Same house as Ruth and all these great players. And it was off Jim Abbott.
Is that right?
Right inside the right field foul pole.
Oh, you just snuck one on him, huh?
Yes.
Sanchez to the right of second base. DJ will tell us other reasons he's a bad guy. Next. 6-0. Early Cincinnati Reds. Nick Castellanos. He was a Tiger, then he was Nicholas Castellanos. Now he's a Red, and he's Nick Castellanos, and he still hits home runs. Tucker Barnhart, leading off the third, made it 2-0. Then Joey Votto, a solo home run on a 2-1 pitch from Jonathan Stever. It was 3-0. That one onto the fairway in center, and then Jesse Winker had the big blow to blow it open. A three-run home run over the ice cream, and a big hug from Joey Votto. A home run hug as we will play the sixth inning with Tyler Mahle still on the mound, DJ. And as a hitter, right, you look up there and you say, okay, well, he's throwing you some stuff to hit, and then you look and it's five scoreless.
Well, you're right, and he has shown that the slider and fastball are above average. And then he mixes in an occasional little changeup curveball. But in the end, it's picking the right side of the plate. You can see that from him as your third time through the lineup. Is he working you down in the way with the slider, or is he working you up and in with the fastball? So you got to pick a side of the plate. You can't cover both. Yeah. Mahle at this point is feeling pretty comfortable. 85 pitches as, you know, he has had a couple of good recent outings. Seven innings, back-to-back starts, giving up just three runs in those outings. But that's what we need, is those three runs to get back in this game.
Madrigal upstairs to swat it to right field. Down the line it goes. Madrigal into second base. Nicky's two strikes has a second two-strike hit this evening. This one a double.
Well, I don't think the league or anybody, American or National, has figured it out. You throw him a neck-high fastball, since they call that strike on him anyway, like he's 6 foot five, he goes ahead and hits these pitches. And he knows how to go ahead and shoot that ball down that right field line with the best of them. And it got a good kick to where the right fielder Castellanos couldn't get that ball quick enough to hold him from picking up that third double of the season. Nice job. That's how you get things started here against a guy that's closing in on 90 pitches.
A chip away, pick up a couple of runs, and one big swing can change the game for you. Yasmani Grandal, first pitch, strike one. Cincinnati's bullpen is 26th in walks per nine, 27th in home runs per nine, and 23rd in relief ERA.
Like I said, let's get this guy out of there.
That's what I'm saying, right? I mean, build the pitch count. Grandal's the guy to do that for you. Ball and a strike on Yasmani.
Let's just say right now that this is the guy, as you said, can extend the count, but also can hit one in the short porch in right field.
He knows the ballpark well, playing with the Brewers last year and visiting the park three times in the NL Central.
And third time through the lineup, where you've got to have a better sense and feel of what's going on.
Two and one. Grandal takes outside off speed. Three balls and a strike.
You can tell right now that Malley is recognizing the fact that maybe he's not as sharp as he has been after giving up the double and now facing the threat of Grandal. So Cincinnati's probably going to get to the point where they go, okay, hold on. We don't want this to unravel. Let's get some movement in the bullpen.
3-1 is upstairs. It's ball four, and suddenly the Sox have two on, nobody out.
And it's time for your T-Mobile ticket to the game. Entering tonight, Jose Abreu has 51 RBIs in 50 team games, something that hasn't happened in baseball since 2013. I mean, and you think about all the good RBI guys that come to bat for each team, and it's Abreu. Following up what he did last year with 123 runs batted in, league leader. And right now, and I think you mentioned it earlier, Jason, that basically he's having a career year, and he's had a lot of great career years already.
Yeah, 2014 rookie of the year, right? And then even with teams that were under 500, putting together big RBI numbers as TJ Antone gets loose in the Reds bullpen.
I look at Abreu, and you mentioned his rookie year. To me, that's his biggest season he's ever had. And it was probably the most locked in I'd ever seen him for a whole season. A lot of other years where he's done a lot of damage has been more battling and just being a good all around hitter to put the numbers up he has. And then he got on the run earlier this year. I mean, unlike any other, where he hit all the home runs and the batting average was just at about 330. I mean, and he's held it there for a while.
Jose gets hit, and now suddenly the bases are loaded for the Sox with nobody out in the sixth inning. And hope Jose's okay. He looks like he's fine.
Well, I don't think we've ever seen a guy like Abreu take as many pitches off the tricep elbow area. And so often he just goes, smiles to his bench and says, I'm all right. I'll rub it tomorrow. Is a guy that has led the team and hit by pitches each year as they try to tie him up. They don't want him to get his arms extended. But just like you said, Jason, here's the thing. Bases loaded, an opportunity right here for the Sox to start doing some damage before the relief pitcher can get finished getting warmed up.
Yeah, again, this is a gettable bullpen for Cincinnati, so the Sox could do some real true damage to Cincinnati late in this game. But right now, bases loaded. Eloy Jimenez off the plate outside, ball one.
And it's nice to see that Mark Carlson's staying with a very strict strike zone tonight.
He's been really good tonight.
Yeah, and obviously, if you're Jimenez, you're thinking, are you going to call that a strike because of the umpires that they've been dealing with?
Aloy's bat goes flying. It's a drop at third and out. The call at second base. Sox do get a run. Madrigal scores. Abreu out at second on a close play off the drop by Suarez at third.
Yeah, I think the only reason they got the out at second is that Abreu's foot probably was popped up in the air on that slide and his foot was hovering over the base. Otherwise, it looked like he beat the throw. And in his mind also, he might have been thinking he needed the breakup too when he was ready to slide into the second baseman. And just like I mentioned, yeah, his foot, mm-hmm. when his knee hit the ground, his front foot popped up in the air, and he was out only because of that reason.
So Eloy to first, Grandal to third, Madrigal scores, and Encarnacion with runners at first and third, one out. And a 6-1 score, and there's ball one.
Well, we were talking about it earlier. This is the time of the game where a pitcher recognizes all that history standing in the batter's box and is now saying, okay, hold on. One swing, and this could be a two-run ball game. So you see him bounce the first pitch in the dirt.
Good tight fastball to 95, 1-1.
Yeah, and the numbers say that Encarnacion is more likely to not catch up to the heater as much as the slider or the changeup floating right there.
One-one. Check swing. He did not go. Two balls and a strike. I was guessing, but I didn't think he went. Did you?
No, it kind of looked like the barrel might have moved a little bit to where you could have maybe called him on that, but in the end, his body didn't really commit.
Oh, Edwin on a fastball that he took a big rip at was late, 2-2.
That fastball is enough to get by Encarnacion, and it has been throughout the year. The good fastballs. He fights him off, but catching up to him is a different story.
So you'd figure another fastball here, right?
You would think. The mistake would be, hey, I'll outthink him. Let me throw him a slider.
High fastball fouled off.
You could tell right there, too. He cheated, did Edwin, to just get a piece of it. Now there's the tell. I think he's pretty much saying, uh-oh. He might chase the slider now down and away.
Pitch number 100 coming for Malley. There was the breaking ball tapped back toward the mound. He's going to get an RBI out of it. And no, they're not. It looked for a moment like Grandal was coming down the line. He decided to retreat. He started to move toward the plate, and then he's back to third. So Jimenez to second, two out.
Yeah, it's just one with the first baseman charging in and your Yasmani Grandal. You don't feel real secure in thinking, and the first baseman stood his ground, actually, but he just didn't feel secure enough to think that the pitcher wouldn't be able to have a play at the plate. Yasmani's just not that fleet of foot to trust that speed, and I don't blame him, to be honest with you. It's not one, unless you went on contact, that you risk.
He did come pretty far down the line there, though, as though he was thinking about it. So Malley's going to leave. Sox will have second and third, two out. Yoan Moncada will bat when we come back in a big spot here in the sixth inning in the series opener.
With host David Kaplan for Football After Show presented by St. Xavier University. That's Sunday, immediately following the Bears-Giants game on NBC Sports Chicago Plus. And TJ Antone is the new pitcher in this ball game, the right-hander. 0-2 in 10 games with a one hold and a 2.76 ERA. He is not part of the problem of that Reds bullpen.
First Lakeside Bank call to the bullpen for Cincinnati tonight. It has been a struggle to close games for the Reds all year long.
Yeah, but as you saw the numbers for him overall, it's just not his problem. He is the guy that's been very reliable.
Moncada goes sprawling down. They check on the swing over at third. And Yoan, I think if actually he stayed upright, they might have gotten him for the swing there, but the fall actually stopped him from going through it.
Yeah, it's one of those rare times where it's okay to play in the dirt. It helped him. You know, and you know, and watching Moncada down, going down, he is like, I'm not going to bring that bat around home plate even as I'm falling. And he landed on his elbow.
That was great strength.
Yes.
To keep from swinging as he crumpled to the ground.
All right, now seeing a pretty good curveball from Anton, and that's something we did not see from the starter Malley at all. So different type of pitching taking place here.
2-1 is in. It's three balls and a strike on Moncada with Luis Robert on deck.
Well, this is the key at bat of the game for the White Sox right now. Yeah, Yoan's not his self from last year, but he has been a guy that has stepped up and delivered some clutch RBIs when they've needed them, and right now they need them.
Calls for time, 3-1 on Moncada. You got Grandal at third, Jimenez at second, and TJ Anton, the rookie, out of the state of Texas on 3-1. That's outside, it's ball four, and the Sox have him loaded again here in the sixth.
Rather surprising to me when you have a 5-run lead, why Anton would waste an off-speed pitch outside rather than saying, all right. And I know there are no true fastball counts anymore, Jason. There really aren't. But if anything, when you're throwing 97 miles an hour and the hitter's not familiar with you, you got to believe in that heat. He did not want to challenge Moncada. Now, he may have only been going by what his catcher's asking him to do, but still, I mean, you got to have
shake.
The confidence. Yeah, you have to have the confidence to say, no, no, he can't touch this.
Robert swings through a breaking ball, strike one.
And we're still seeing with Luis that he just doesn't trust that he can catch up to the fastball. And he starts swinging at the ball right out of the pitcher's hand. If he could just get it in his mind to jam himself a little bit, he'll fare better.
What do you mean jam himself a little bit?
Stay on the ball. That means you're throwing your hands at the baseball. And he's not. He's throwing the barrel at the baseball, what ends up being too quick, and he's out and around the pitches. So you throw your hands at the baseball, and it forces you to actually stay on that slider better.
Two strike count, and he goes down swinging. Sox get a run. Could have been more. We'll go bottom six. 6-1 Cincinnati. So you get drafted right in the first round, and then you say, well, I'll go through the minor leagues, and then I'll make it to the majors at some point, hopefully soon. Hopefully soon is a couple months later for young Garrett Crochet, 21 years old, the left-hander with the fastball and the wipeout slider, who comes out of the University of Tennessee to the Chicago White Sox, 11th overall, 2020 draft. He's out of the state of Mississippi. Talking to him a little bit during the early part of the pandemic, just for about 20 minutes on Skype. He is a very confident young man. He believes in his abilities. He's got a nasty slider, and you see Chris Sale reaching the majors the year being drafted back in 2010. There have been some comparisons, not from Sox people, but just the profile of Crochet, tall, slender, lefty with a wipeout slider, to a guy like Chris Sale.
Well, I mean, obviously you're going to draw the comparisons because it's the nearest thing to Chris Sale that
right.
we've had. And here he is, a guy that throws this hard and has that slider like Chris Sale has had over his career. But the difference is, what I have checked numbers wise, you know, you're going off of potential with Crochet because his numbers in college just weren't wipeout numbers. And to me, that means he was just overthrowing the baseball.
First pitch down and away, 88 miles an hour. But I mean, this is really a no lose situation for the Sox. You're walking up toward the playoffs. You know that for sure. And you get Crochet into a 6-1 game in Cincinnati.
Perfect, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, Yasmani Grandal just got shocked by that breaking ball upstairs.
Well, and then he pointed to his eyes like I couldn't see it. So I don't know what exactly that meant, or maybe he's telling him, hey, check the signs a little better.
Yeah, that may have been one finger.
You know, you crossed me up.
1-1 is, oh boy, a fastball at 100. That'll knock you off the plate pretty quick if you're Brian Goodwin, who has no tape of Crochet from the minors. You got to watch SEC Network.
Yeah, this is interesting.
I talk about all legs coming at you, by the way, Garrett Crochet.
Let me just explain what I'm seeing right now, Jason. That last fastball at 100 miles an hour, from the delivery he's featuring, it seems effortless, and for a hitter, you know it's there before you can even think about it.
Well, you can see why Mike Shirley and the Sox staff love the arm.
Oh, I can definitely see that. And numbers wise, the key is going to be, can he command the strike zone? I think it can be taught, as you see the high leg kick and the definite drive, long stride, and creating a lot of torque with that upper body.
100, strike three. Garrett Crochet, keep that baseball. His first major league strikeout just a couple of months after he was drafted. How about his year?
Well, I mean, look, we've talked about how bad 2020 has been for the world and for the nation. But right now, Garrett Crochet, he couldn't think this is a better year in his whole life. The dream come true, first big league batter faced, and he strikes him out, just like his dream probably has been forever, to get to the big leagues with this arm and strike guys out.
Right now, just stop in this moment, who's having a better 2020 than Garrett Crochet across the world?
No one.
First pitch fouled away at 100, strike one.
You know, we can also draw a quick comparison to Randy Johnson when he first got to the big leagues. He threw two pitches. He threw a fastball and an occasional slider that he couldn't command. And then he figured out how to throw that for a strike, and everything changed.
.101 on the fastball, and easy for Garrett Crochet.
Well, you know, right now I just look at Yasmani Grandal. He's looking at his glove, his mitt. He's going, wait a minute, is it okay? Think about having to catch that. It doesn't feel good on the hand if you miscatch it just a little bit.
Start calling a lot more sliders. 0-2, fastball inside, get out of here. Two down, Garrett Crochet is carving.
It makes me think about Amir Garrett, the short reliever for the Reds, that's watching this going, okay, hold on, is this guy trying to copy me? As Garrett, Amir Garrett, has a huge leg kick as well and a good fastball, not at this speed. But this is something special to watch right now, and let's see him do it again.
How about Tucker Barnhart, lefty lefty? Good luck to you. And here's the last pitch.
And you can actually see that Crochet, he pulls his head off of target. As violent as that delivery is at the finish, his head kind of pulls down. He loses sight of the target, but he's already locked it in his mind when he's releasing the baseball. And it's going in the direction he's hoping it ends up. Right?
He's right on top of you. So perceived velocity, right? You're it's 100.
Yes.
You're seeing 102, 103, aren't you?
Well, absolutely. From the release point, because he's a bigger, taller guy.
Contact to first. Yeah, we can get used to this. Whoo, doctor. Garrett Crochet, when flamingos attack.
Crochet in his major league debut, folks, all he did was go out there and strike out the first two batters that he faced, and then he ended Tucker Barnhart's at bat on a weak roller to first base for a 1-2-3 first big league inning. Congratulations, Garrett Crochet. Well done.
Whoa. I mean, that was shocking.
You know, we obviously know about the arm. We know about a scouting report, but you don't know what it is until you see it. And we just saw it.
Well, I would question whether or not Cincinnati actually did see it. You said Randy Johnson early in his career. Did you face him early?
I did, when he was with Montreal, when he first got called up.
What did that look like to you?
That, what we just saw?
Yeah.
Yeah, very similar. And but at that time, you know, here's the irony. When I see guys throw this hard, I give them all the credit in the world. It's amazing and it's hard to catch up to. But at that time, I was a fastball hitter. So Randy Johnson threw the 100 mile an hour fastball, and I hit two doubles down the left field line on him. I didn't see him for years later until I joined the White Sox in 94. And he threw the slider then, and since then it's not been fair.
When do you pick up the ball against somebody like that? When do you first see it?
Well, you see it right out of the hand, but it's more of a blur rather than reading the label on the baseball. You know, you're like going, here comes a blur. But, you know, it is really okay, and it's easy. We see guys turn around 100 mile an hour heat, no problem. I mean, Nate Jones, who's with the Reds now, somebody that threw 98 miles an hour, and I can think back to Miguel Sano turning that around two occasions a couple of years ago like it was nothing. Mm-hmm. That's because he anticipated, he timed it, and he put the swing to it because he knew it was coming.
Mazzara fouls it away after fouling what seems like the 130,000th ball off his shoe this year.
Yeah, that's true. But really, I mean, it does come down to you have to have a really good balancing pitch to throw 100 miles an hour and keep a major league hitter off of that. And what we're saying with Crochet, he might have it with that slider. It's a good slider. Right now, what we're seeing from the hard throwing right hander Antone, he's got a slider as well and a curveball.
It is amazing that we're in an era of baseball where guys who throw like 95, 96, you're like, eh.
I still am blown away by that fact.
Mazzara in the air, beyond second base. Who's got it? It is the second baseman Moustakas for out number one. Hey, this summer, head to your favorite store and grab some cold Modelo Especial. Perfect to enjoy while watching the White Sox, and while you're there, enter for a chance to win 2021 season tickets. No purchase necessary. Illinois residents 21 and over only. Ends October 27th. Visit crownimportscontest.com for rules. Well, pitchers on the bench huddled around talking about what they just saw. Do you guys see that? Do you see that?
Yeah, you know, the thing is they don't really know him very well, obviously. He's somebody that was just drafted. I mean, just drafted. He wasn't in camp with him. Nope. It was an extended camp here during the summer, which was a couple of weeks. And that's it. So it's not like he's best friends with the big leaguers. They just don't know him yet.
They do now.
They do now. And they all want to be his friend. Hey, buddy, how you doing? I knew you could do it. I believed in you since I heard about you in college. They're all saying that to him now.
Yeah, yeah. Quick thing. Do you do plyometrics? Like, what are you weighted balls? What are you doing? Uh-huh.
You know, the thing about being a veteran player is you usually like to take a young guy under your wing and give him some inside information and teach him stuff. Right now they're lined up to be that guy. So, oh no, it was me that helped him along. I was the guy that,
that's right,
helped him turn the corner.
Everybody, yeah, took him under their wing. 1-2 tipped in and out of the glove. Steve Cishek getting loose in the White Sox bullpen as the Sox try to go after the Cincinnati bullpen and TJ Antone. 2-2 for Sanchez.
And we got to remember, with all the excitement here of Crochet making his debut, the White Sox, they're running out of outs. They got to stack something together here.
Guided in the air, foul. But tomorrow's game will be over Fox National, so we'll have the day off. You'll be back on radio with Andy Mazur.
Wait a minute. It's not my contract. I get to follow you guys. Since I came over here for a day, I get the day off too, right?
Social distancing.
We
have to have the day off separately.
All right. We're definitely about 15 feet apart in this booth.
It's true. We have a very expansive location here.
Yes, yeah, we do.
Zoning ordinance.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I'm just, you know, I was going to bring the big plexiglass and put it here too, just to protect myself. But you said I didn't have to.
Well, oddly enough, you did that last year in Washington.
And we didn't need the space.
2-2 and a ground ball to second. It's Moustakas for out number two.
Hey, the White Sox Talk podcast has two new episodes for you to enjoy. Chuck Garfine and company discuss clinching the playoffs, why the Sox are winning, and the AL Central, and much more. Subscribe for free today.
Chuck is going to end up doing an emergency podcast about Garrett Crochet, I feel like.
Well, I think he's already overworked. I don't think he wants to run in there and start that right now.
Chuck? Yeah. Chuck's a podcast machine. He churns out product like nobody's business.
More than you?
Oh, yeah.
No way.
Chuck does a podcast like breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Do you have a podcast?
I don't.
Oh.
You want to start one?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Maybe we should do that.
Absolutely. We'll get on that right after this game.
Okay. Oh, check my schedule.
Not available
we
that
should,
time.
You know, we should. We should have a White Sox announcer podcast and rotate.
All right. Well, you heard it here first, folks. Jason has presented it, and it will be coming to you soon.
We are coming to you. One ball and two strikes on Madrigal.
The White Sox have had their one big inning opportunity in the sixth where they had the base runners, but just not the big hit. Madrigal is the guy that got it started with his third big league double.
Nick's got some power in that bat, don't you think?
No.
You don't?
It's the opposite of that.
You don't think he'll have some gap-to-gap power?
Oh, yeah, he's got that.
That's what I'm saying.
Well, when you said some power, I thought you meant actually over the fence type stuff.
He does. He can hit a home run.
Foul balls, yeah.
Oh, come on.
No, you're right. He can hit a home run. He's not Ronnie Belliard or somebody like that.
No, he's not going to hit 30.
No.
But he's got it in there.
Well, he can run into it, absolutely.
Foul ball. I hope he hits a homer right here.
Oh, I hope he does, too. My first big league home run was in Cincinnati.
Was it really?
Yes, it was.
Crosley Field.
There you go. Oh, there you go. Riverfront. Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's why I love that stadium, Jason.
Up the middle. TJ Antone for out number three. We'll find out who it was. Is it Jose Rijo? We'll find out after this.
Mobile banking and digital home financing. You get 40,000 plus free ATMs nationwide, and they're the only bank with fun rewards. Rediscover neighborhood banking at emarketbank.com/75. It's easy for me to say.
You ever back in the day, you sit with your friends and you just play marbles?
Let me just tell you this right now. I was a master of marbles.
You play, yeah, great. Great at marbles.
Oh, my goodness.
C-Sheck out of the bullpen after Crochet in the seventh inning. This might be one of the most nondescript games of the 2020 season.
You're
right?
Welcome. I brought it to you.
No, but there was a predicate there. I was going to finish with something that made it really intriguing. If this ends up being a 6-1 Cincinnati win, it will be an eminently forgettable baseball game for a lot of reasons in one of the best seasons in recent memory for the White Sox. But Garrett Crochet and what he did in the sixth inning is a glimmer of light that none of us expected when we woke up this morning.
Absolutely, you're right. We didn't even have the information that he was joining the club until midday. So you're right, Ed. That's a great way to put this in the proper perspective this game so far.
Three balls and no strikes on Akiyama. You played for his team, the Cebu Lions.
He owned it?
In Japan. Well, he ended up playing there for 9 years, so it's more his team than yours after 2 years.
I was there first.
Okay. You were there 95, 96, is that right?
Yes. The White Sox forced me to leave. They said, you got to go. Get out of here.
Because you said it and because you're giving me grief.
Never.
The Cebu Lions made the postseason the year before you got there and the year after you got there.
He caught that. I trained them while I was there.
You did? You taught them how to win?
I taught them how to win.
But on a time release basis.
And then they said, all right, thank you for your service. You got to go.
Ball four. And we got to go. Introducing MLB Film Room powered by Google Cloud. Create custom reels and search 3.5 million videos. Watch, create, share only at whitesox.com/filmroom. I want to know what your experience was like in Japan. What do you think out there?
By the way, to my dismay, I got to a championship team thinking, this is the best. Only to find out they were in transition with their starting pitching.
Oh.
Going to youth, and the older guys were not as good as they used to be. And then the younger guys were just taking over. And when I left, they had it figured out. So it wasn't me.
So that's how it happened. So yeah. You had a lovely experience, I'm gathering?
I absolutely loved it there.
You did?
I wouldn't change that experience. But I love to learn new cultures, travel. And I made some great friends there. The culture was amazing. Would never take those 2 years away and give them back to Major League Baseball. But I loved it. Yeah.
You know, it's interesting learning a little bit about the Korea baseball organization and just watching the different types of swings and the struggles of the bullpen sometimes and just the tendencies and the culture. You learn a lot about the game of baseball when you watch an international game, too, I feel like.
Well, you know what? It's similar, yet it's different.
That's called a strike, 2-1.
Castellanos does not agree with that, and he's probably got a beef there. But, yeah, I think, you know, when I got to Japan, I expected it to be baseball, and it was. And they thought a little differently, and they definitely worked pregame and postgame differently. It was called overkill. They did way too much stuff, wear themselves out, so they would be tired for the game.
Castellanos, center field, Luis Robert makes a catch, and one gone. Well, we saw Donaldson get thrown out during a home run. We nearly saw Castellanos get thrown out after a home run or before a fly ball out as he was pointing out to the left field area where he hit the home run, debating with Carlson on that strike that he didn't think was a strike.
Yeah, let's just say there's a lot of unique things we've seen this year.
It's a tough year for a lot of people. It has been a strange season, but the one thing I'll say yesterday, and I don't know what your night was like after the 1-10 start when the Sox clinched, but hearing from so many people who I grew up with that are Sox fans and people on social media, just about getting to talk White Sox playoff baseball with friends they haven't seen a lot over the course of the last bunch of months, it was a pretty neat day for Sox fans yesterday.
Oh, you're so right. I actually went and had dinner with Eric Vates, owner of Orland Park Mazda, and Carmine, one of his guys out there. And believe it or not, a good friend of ours, Gene Honda.
You had dinner with Gene Honda?
Yes, last night.
How's Gene?
He's doing great, missing being here.
He's a wonderful guy.
Yeah. I mean, but he misses being part of what we're doing right now. So it was great to spend some time with him, that's for sure. I'll see him next week. Tracy Williams has his golf tournament that we're going to be part of next Thursday. It's an annual golf tournament that works for this, or actually does as a charity event for the Spectrios Eye Institute. And this year it's in honor of Ed Farmer. So that's going to be next Thursday out at Prairie Landing. And Gene's going to be there emceeing it. So
fantastic.
It's something that I'm looking forward to.
As you say that, Tracy's a wonderful guy, too.
Yes.
As you say this, I just realize fans, staff members, people around the ballpark, this is a season where you really do appreciate how many wonderful souls are around the White Sox. In the air, left-hand side, pretty well hit. Eloy watches it fly off the wall. And so Joey Votto hits himself a wall ball. Throw to the plate is bouncing away, and Cincinnati adds one on a Joey Votto RBI double. Akiyama scores.
Well, Akiyama read that perfectly, knowing it wasn't going to be played, and he had no problem coming around to score. Fastball off the outside corner, and Votto just reaching out, showing you how strong he is. A lot of top hand involved, and he hits it halfway up the left field wall. And Joey Votto having himself a night. Just a hit away from the cycle.
Well, look, Cincinnati comes into today in second place in a tie with St. Louis in the NL Central. And right now, the Twins are down 1-0 to the Cubs, bottom five, as an update for the AL Central at this point. But St. Louis beat Pittsburgh in a doubleheader game 6-5 in game one. They're trailing 2-1 in game two. So Cincinnati could, in fact, gain on St. Louis and be in second place all alone when this day ends once again.
Yeah, interesting NL Central,
isn't it?
Yeah, I was looking at that and realizing that the Cubs, the top of the division, and St. Louis, and you should normally consider Milwaukee as a contending team, but St. Louis, you know, is going to be there. They're a team that always battles towards the top, but Cincinnati has been a pleasant surprise for their city.
A lot of models and people who do models and people who project out who might be helped most by a 60-game season picked the Sox in the AL and the Reds in the NL to be the teams best assisted by the short schedule. And Cincinnati's playing like that right now.
Well, you know what? That's great that the predictions are kind of coming to fruition, but they missed it with the White Sox.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's got nothing to do with 60 games, how well this team's played. To be the first team in the AL that clinched a playoff spot pretty much tells you that they were going to be a solid team no matter what, ahead of all those other teams that were picked before them to get to the postseason.
There's a swing and a miss, strike three, and Suarez goes down, two gone.
And the U.S. Open returns to NBC as the world's best golfers take on golf's greatest challenge. The U.S. Open from historic Wingfoot Golf Club continues tomorrow at 10 on NBC.
You ever play Wingfoot?
That is one that, unfortunately, my partner Ed Farmer never got me out on.
That's like 1% of courses he never got you out on.
That's about right. We talked about it, and he said, I've got to get you out there. Just we didn't get the time.
Center field, Robert makes the catch. Always appreciate the time you have. 7-1 Cincinnati after 7. With the lead. And a big White Sox hello to Michael Kelly, who is struggling with some medical issues, but a huge White Sox fan who watches every game. And here's hoping Michael Kelly is watching this game tonight, because he's a huge White Sox fan. Brother Rice High School graduate, has been to Houston to see the White Sox World Series in 2005. And so to Michael and your family, hello, hope you're watching, and we're thinking about you.
Absolutely, Michael.
Yasmani Grandal, two strikes here in the eighth inning.
You know, we have been so fortunate over the years to have so many tremendous fans, season ticket holders, fans that follow us on the road, and we get to know some of those fans. So it's nice to hear that Michael is one of those loyal followers.
There's one trip every year, it feels like, where we go on the road and we're walking into the hotel after the game, walk home from the ballpark.
Yes.
And there's this group of like 20 Sox fans in the lobby.
Yes.
That somehow beat you to the hotel.
Absolutely.
They were they stayed for the final out and then hoofed it to have another group dinner and
yes,
a couple of drinks, talk White Sox. And it warms my heart every time we run into a big group of Sox fans on the road.
Joe Simmons is somebody that leads those groups to different cities during the year. They'll pick a city and they'll say, this is going to be this year's trip. And last year, I believe it was Philadelphia.
I think that was right. They got to see a 9,000 inning ball game.
Yes.
One down.
Let's go ahead and check out our momentum maker, and it's presented by First Midwest Bank. Look at this starting pitcher tonight, Tyler Mahle, somebody that got locked in early, and unfortunately, too often, he missed the White Sox bats. He picked up 7 strikeouts through his 5 2/3 innings worth of work, only giving up the 1 run on a fielder's choice in the 6th inning, and he faced one more batter after that before it was exit stage left.
And then T.J. Antone, the rare spelling of T-E-J-A-Y, T.J.
Yeah, that's very literal.
Why don't you go D-E-J-A-Y?
I have often.
You have?
You know my middle name?
I did moments ago when I was looking at your baseball reference page.
J.
It's Jay?
Yes.
Is it really J-A-Y?
Yes.
Wow.
DJ.
But you don't add the you don't add the E, though.
No, I'm not that crazy.
I want to know what word you would have used if you weren't on the air. To shortstop and 2 down here in the 8th. Eloy will bat. Looking for a way to celebrate the Wintrust Crosstown Series at home? Are you?
Not me.
Visit. Thank you. Visit lakeshorebev.com/Cubs. Dash Socks for a list of bars and restaurants offering to-go packages for the series. Plus, find out how you could win a watch party viewing kit from Goose Island. Sounds like fun.
Well, I'd have fun if I was with you, yes.
Oh, thanks, DJ.
You're driving.
D-E-J-A-Y.
I almost ducked right there on that foul ball back.
Thank goodness you said that, because I've been saying that to Stoney all year long on the road games.
Yes.
When we're doing the games from our own ballpark. I've been jumping all year, and he looks at me like I'm absolutely out of my mind.
Well, it's not because of that. It was other reasons he was looking at you like that. But
wow, super fantastic to have you here.
You know, it's fairly natural. We have these home games where we have to look out for foul balls.
Right.
And then all of a sudden they leave and, well, a foul ball's hit and you think you've forgot to pay attention to the action on the field. So you should respond with a nice little flinch.
How about the game in Pittsburgh last week when, while the game in Pittsburgh was going on, there was a game with the Schaumburg crew out on the field and there was a foul ball back toward the booth in like the eighth inning of the Sox-Pirates game.
You're not going to believe this. That particular game, I closed the windows because of that reason.
Did you really?
I did. I said, wait a minute, wait a minute. We're watching the monitor, not the field on everything. I'm not going to be snuck up on, Jason. I said, no, not me.
You are a smart dude. Eloy, first base side, and a dive from Joey Votto. Ends the inning. 7-1 your score after 7.5 tonight. You're out of the long while.
Yeah, Jose Ruiz gets the opportunity after he was just recalled from Schaumburg. This is our call to the pen, and let's just say Ruiz didn't do anything wrong in his two outings. Two innings, one hit, one strikeout, and that's it. I mean, it's not like, hey, Jose, you're struggling, you're not doing your job, you got to go again. So he gets an opportunity here tonight in Cincinnati, and hopefully he takes advantage of it.
This is one of those games, yes, you'd love to win every game down the stretch, and no, I'm not rationalizing losing a game because nobody ever wants to lose a game. But you have the opportunity with a clinch playoff berth, and you're playing Cincinnati, and you have a spot in the rotation in Stever where you're just sort of feeling out and seeing what you get. You can bring in Crochet, you can bring in Ruiz, you don't bury the bullpen of the guys that you usually pitch in a close game, and it helps you get to the finish line in a way that another close game wouldn't.
Well, we already know that this is the kind of game today that in Rick Renteria's mind, it was almost as if it was a day off. It was a day to breathe from all the tension and stress this team's been feeling to try and lock in a postseason spot. That's why Tim Anderson's not in this game.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a day where, yeah, we still got the majority of our stars in this lineup. But I guarantee it's a day also that all of them have had some kind of weight lifted off of their bodies. The stress is gone, the tension's gone. They'll give it this day, I think, Jason, and they'll be back. That focus, that intensity, be back tomorrow. It's sad to say it's not there tonight, but I can see and you can see the difference in the intensity just in this game compared to every other game.
Agreed. Agreed. And some days over the course of 162, for sure you need that.
Yes.
And over the course of 60, you know, a third of a season, a little bit more than a third of a season, everybody needs one day.
Absolutely.
Tomorrow, Trevor Bauer on the mound for Cincinnati. He's been awesome. We know all about Trevor Bauer and his dynamic opinion of how to tunnel pitches and everything that comes along with that. But he's been a 171 ERA guy for the year, and the hope is that Dallas Keuchel will throw tomorrow. That's the plan for the Sox.
Yeah, and I've been talking about Dallas and thinking, you know, oh, the possibility of yesterday, who knows today. But in the end, I think you set him up to where he can get the starts needed to get ready for the postseason. Simple as that. And if that is tomorrow, I think it's pretty perfect, and you're hoping that he can give you six perfect innings against this Reds team that somehow is rejuvenated and they're trying to win their sixth straight game.
Cincinnati playing some of the best baseball around right now. And look, the Sox still may not lose a game to Minnesota before the night ends. The Cubs are up 1-0 on Minnesota. Kyle Hendricks on the mound for the Cubs tonight.
Yeah, I think that's big. And we're pulling for the Cubs.
Yeah, that's something.
That's exactly right.
But look, with only 10 games left, including tonight for the Sox, the window's closing for Minnesota with the Sox holding the tiebreaker. That is a firm three in the lead for the Sox in the Central.
Right, and I believe if the White Sox can't turn things around here tonight, I think Ricky and staff have to re-emphasize that every game for the rest of the year is uber important. You can't afford to not go out there and be focused at the highest level, especially since you only get the one day off and the playoffs start. It's not like you want to give anybody a mental break. You got to keep that intensity every single day after today, in my opinion.
Yeah, that's a good point, especially because you don't want to lose like even 5 of 10 closing with how hot this team was. You want to keep that mindset, right?
Well, I just personally, I want to make sure if I'm a manager that my guys get it. They understand the importance of winning the division one and the importance of not letting that intensity go going into the three-game series that comes right behind it.
Strike three, Ruiz with two outs, and we go to the studio to see what's coming up on White Sox Post Game Live presented by Subaru. Adam Holt, Chuck Garfine, guys.
Well, I'm glad you added in my prime because I couldn't hit him from up here.
That's now. Your prime is now, I feel like.
I get younger as I grow older, but that's a good question, guys. Let's just say I wouldn't have fared well.
You didn't like guys that threw at 101?
I didn't mind that. I just didn't like guys that threw a 101 and I didn't feel they knew where it was going. And if I checked his historic numbers, I go, this guy doesn't really command the strike zone.
But then he came in and he was throwing strikes tonight.
Yeah, but I'd have to see that more than once.
Yeah. Problem is you only get one look at him tonight. If you're Cincinnati, you're like, what is this?
That's it. And that's why you become a little overwhelmed by, you know, three or four pitches. You're like, he can have them. You know, I'm not really leaning in right now when I don't know this guy.
Garrett Crochet, who has been through the ringer on the pitcher's mound, he got hit in the jaw with a line drive and ended up trying to throw through having a broken jaw. On the mound, I mean, he's a super tough guy. He's from the state of Mississippi, went through the University of Tennessee, and we were chatting earlier a couple months ago after he got drafted. He's got this giant Tennessee flag in the room that he was sitting in. Like, he is Rocky Top through and through. He went to Tennessee to become a better baseball player, was hoping to be a major leaguer from very young. You could see him on the basketball court being one of those guys, like, just bigger than everybody,
right,
and just putting it in over the top of the little kids, but athletic as can be on the mound. We saw,
well, obviously from the appearance of him tonight, three batters, I mean, we have no negatives.
Nope.
And he is human, so there's going to be some bump in the road when
That's
we see
right.
him again,
but tonight,
yes,
none,
nothing,
and
perfect, perfecto,
yeah, as impressive as you're going to see.
Absolutely. It's like having a debut as a hitter. You go up to pinch hit with the bases loaded and you get a you hit a grand slam. There you go. You might as well retire.
Who'd you hit your first career home run against?
Cincinnati? Danny Jackson.
Danny Jackson.
Yes.
You didn't retire after that?
I'm retiring after tonight.
Okay. Ruiz retires the side. You got a rally cap, DJ? Danger on and off the field at Rush. Excellence is just the beginning. Sal Romano made his debut for the year on Monday and stranded the bases loaded against the Pirates.
Well, that's a nice debut. It's along the lines of pinch hitting and hitting that grand slam I was talking about.
Yeah, that's the reliever version.
Yes.
Good moving fastball for strike one to Encarnacion. It'll be Edwin, then Yoan and Luis scheduled here in the ninth in a quiet night for the Sox offense in the opener in Cincinnati. Don Orsillo and A.J. Pierzynski will have the call tomorrow on Fox.
Okay, then.
You and Andy will have the call on the radio.
Yes, we will. By the way, I didn't mention this earlier, but I'd like to now. Jeff Chanel's birthday.
That's right.
Yeah, well, I think Gene Honda shared that with me yesterday, and I hope he was being honest with me. Happy birthday, Jeff.
Jeff Chanel is one of the finest people you'll ever meet.
Yes.
He is in charge of the scoreboard room at Guaranteed Rate Field as this to center. Is out number one, also a White Sox historian.
And if we take a moment to take a look at our Grandview Homes home run leaderboard for your Chicago White Sox. Right at the top of the list, Jose Abreu, as you can see. The White Sox with three big boppers and double digits in home runs. Eloy Jimenez with his 13, Luis Robert. He got off to a hot start and since has cooled down with the long ball, but you know it's there for him, just like for this guy, Yoan Moncada. boy, we need him and his hot bat to get going right here toward the end of the year.
Yeah, it's been a tough year for Yoan medically.
Yes.
And then fatigue wise and what he's dealt with, but trying to play through it. He's played a very good third base, been a patient hitter, but the power is just not there yet.
No, and you know it's there. You know it's just hiding. It's hibernating. We need it to be awakened and utilized, and it's going to have to come down this stretch for the White Sox. You know, he's an RBI guy in our lineup to me that, 85 runs batted in last year, 25 home runs. That's a big miss in your lineup if you don't know that is present day in and day out. Others have picked him up, but it's just there, and if it comes alive, look out.
There are a couple spots in this order that are in that category.
Yes.
If you get a little bit more power wise from a few spots, an already dangerous lineup is a dragon breathing fire.
Yeah, and you know what? Right now, I'm curious to see how our lineup plays out the rest of the year. What are the guys that are going to really start lining up for the postseason?
Yoan right hand side and Moustakas two gone.
And let's take a look at our upcoming schedule presented by Volkswagen. You see the Cincinnati Reds are on the docket Sunday, and then it's off to Cleveland for four straight night games. 5-10 starts right here, and then close out the season against the Northsiders, the Cubs, right down the road.
It's hard to believe that we are going to not be doing this on a nightly basis after the playoffs. I mean, Steve and I will be off the air because National picks up the playoffs. We encourage you all to listen to Andy and DJ and enjoy the radio broadcast of all White Sox games on WGN as this goes to right field on a line, and there is out number three, and that will do it. Cincinnati 7-1 the final score on a night that may in the long run be known simply as the night Garrett Crochet made his White Sox debut.
You know what, Jason, that's